Clemson, South Carolina, the site of a late season ACC rubber match between Florida State and Clemson. Two teams ranked in the top 13 in the nation, and there's plenty on the line, not just a series victory here. Mike Martin making history two nights ago, becoming the winningest coach in the history of NCAA baseball with their Game 1 series victory over Clemson in 13 innings. Right now, Florida State sits 3.5 behind Clemson in the Atlantic Division. The Tigers leading the way. Florida State picked first in the preseason, but Clemson two games clear of NC State. As we welcome you inside the press box here, Dari Noka alongside former Arizona State assistant coach Mike Rooney, former first-round draft pick Kyle Peterson. History. We got to go down and talk to the legend. History made by Mike Martin. Pretty special what he's been able to do naturally, and here he is tonight.
Yeah, I mean, he's one of the great ambassadors of college baseball, and obviously now sits atop of the mountain as far as wins go within this game. And for Mike Martin, there may not be a better gentleman that you will see in college baseball, really the game in general. So he ties Augie Garrido's record last weekend against Miami, and then breaks it in Game 1 of this series. Steven Wells goes deep in extra innings. They would hold on to get the Game 1 win. So the win, which Mike Martin will talk about and showed a little emotion about, Runes had a chance to talk to him before the game, clearly important as far as history goes. This series is important, too, because they're fighting for national seeds.
Yeah, guys, you're right. You think about it, this weekend started with history, but now it's about 2018. Both clubs could be a top 8 national seed, which means you host all the way to Omaha. You look at it for Clemson, the RPI 10, that's a little on the high side, but they've been very good in the league. Florida State with the opposite problem, RPI at 8. Here's the deal, guys. A marquee series win like this could be a difference maker.
Absolutely. Forget national rankings, which are 13-6. They certainly are important. The fans love them. But RPI is a bigger deal to that committee, and Florida State's got the two-spot edge right now. As you see the Seminoles lineup, Rhett Applin will be batting third, leading the team in conference play and hitting.
We're going to like this guy, Applin. It's an old-school left-handed singles hitter, gentlemen.
And Kyle Peterson, we got Jake Higginbotham, the typical Sunday starter, getting the go here. He's making his 12th start. They're 9-2 in his first 11.
He's got stuff. I mean, power left, he can get into the low 90s, lives off his fastball, two different breaking balls, a slider and a changeup. I think the fastball has to carry him early right here. If he can command, especially that glove side, so into the right-handed hitter, Higginbotham can go deeper into this ballgame.
And with that, we are off at Doug Kingsmore Stadium on the campus of Clemson University. Steven Wells, the hero two nights ago, what ended up being the game-winning home run in the 13th that allowed Mike Martin to get that record. Finds himself down 0-2.
Seniors flashed a little power. The one thing he will flash is a big-time arm from right field. Wells is a guy that not many take chances to run on.
Ball 1-2 now to Wells.
That's, you know, KP, you mentioned it, Higginbotham, that breaking ball. He's got to find that. That's something the Florida State hitters, if you're a one-pitch person, they can really get after you.
And he gets him looking for the first out of the ball game from Jake Higginbotham.
You know, KP, that message is going throughout the entire Florida State dugout. They're trying to eliminate pitches, cannot eliminate the breaking ball just yet.
No, that's a good point, because you know the scouting report coming in was that. Is if you get the fastball, let's hunt a fastball, let's force him to throw the breaking ball over for a strike. The previous one couldn't land, that one lands for a quick strikeout.
In comes the junior left fielder, switch hitting Jackson Luke. Luke Jr. from Orlando led this team in hitting each of the past two seasons. Does have a home run in this series. It came in yesterday's Clemson win. He takes the fastball in for strike, and it's 0-2 quickly. Second straight hitter. Higginbotham's got ahead of 0-2.
KP, fastball in, baby. That is a hitter's nightmare right there.
And that's where he likes to go. He's more comfortable throwing that fastball glove side. So into the right-handed hitter. This Tim tries to elevate, can't get the swing. I think the thing to watch is, can he throw the breaking ball out of that same tunnel? So can he throw the fastball glove side and then come back and wrap it around a right hitter's feet?
That ball hit into the shallow grass. Easy play from the freshman second baseman, Sam Hall. He is a freshman, but it's a veteran defense that lines up behind Higginbotham.
I'll tell you what, guys, there's a lot of seniors in that defense for Clemson, but Logan Davidson, the shortstop, that's a first-round pick in 2019 for me. He checks every box. He's got the physique, the frame, and a tremendous athlete at shortstop.
Senior on both corners, Patrick Cromwell at third, Chris Williams, power hitter with 14 home runs over there at first.
What do you like about him, Runes?
You know, it's just he's tall. He's 6'2". He's going to get much stronger. He's got speed. He's a switch hitter. He's got the pedigree. He's the son of a big leaguer.
Applin slow roller played by Williams over at first. The flip to Higginbotham, and it was an easy inning for Jake Higginbotham. Three up and three down. Good start. Cole Sands, junior righty, stepping to the mound for Florida State. This is the ACC on ESPN from Clemson, South Carolina. Tigers hosting Florida State rubber game after the Noles won Saturday and Clemson won on Sunday. Dory Noka, Kyle Peterson, Mike Rooney. And guys, let's start at the top here. Logan Davidson, the sophomore shortstop, will lead things off.
I tell you guys, if you're a draft Nick, this is a name to write down for next year. Switch hitting shortstop, 6'3", tremendous athlete, son of a big leaguer, checks every box. And don't forget about Seth Beer now. This kid was a Golden Spikes preseason guy that I personally picked him. It's just everybody pitches around Seth Beer.
Yeah, it's been a different Beer. Was a national freshman of the year his freshman year and really had as good offensive season this year as anybody. Davidson's cut down on the errors this year. And Cole Sands is a guy that Florida State's going to need towards the end of the season if they're really going to make a run. The stuff is real.
Yep.
And for Sands, the fastball can get into the mid-90s. I think a question is how long can he hold it? And how long can he go? He's coming back after a couple weeks where he was on the shelf. They'd like 75 to 85 pitches if they can get from Sands. But for Florida State to make a deep run this year, they need Sands to be good on the mound.
Watch this first inning. It is key for him. He's given up 27 earned runs on the season. 13 of those 27 have come in the first inning. And he starts 2-0.
You nailed it, KP. When you think about Sands, he was the Friday night guy. They need him to be that type of guy. If there's one issue for Florida State, it's do you have that go-to guy on the mound?
That ball well hit, laced down the first baseline, just foul from Davidson.
And when you lose a guy like Tyler Holton the first weekend of the season,
yeah,
who you think is going to be your Friday or Saturday guy the whole year, he was really good for him last year and was going to start at first base. I mean, the only day he wasn't going to be in the offensive lineup was the day that he was pitching. So you lose a middle-of-the-lineup hitter and one of your weekend starters, they really need Sands to be good.
Now 3-1 to the leadoff man, Logan Davidson. Davidson, four hits in the series.
Speaks to the season Florida State's had. Can you imagine losing a preseason All-American Friday night arm, and you're still in the middle of May, chance to be a top eight seed?
Davidson, high fly ball, shallow left center field. In comes the left fielder, Luke, and that's the first out. All right, take a look at Florida State defensively. Junior, freshman, senior, left to right in the outfield. Seniors on the right side of the infield. Rafael Bornegal getting the start at second. Red Applin, we showed you offensively over at first. Drew Mendoza has struggled a bit over the last month or so with the plate. More on him in a little bit. Cal Raleigh just will not come out of the lineup.
And had a huge bounce back year for Raleigh. Really has had a great junior season.
So the catcher, Kyle Wilkie, steps in. 13-game hitting streak for Wilkie coming in. You know, Clemson head coach Monty Lee was telling us earlier that two-hole spot, he values that so much in this lineup. And I know every coach does, but he specifically mentioned that spot. It's why he's got his catcher Wilkie in there, because he tends to deliver. He sees that as a big RBI potential with Davidson leading things off.
Wilkie was a guy they weren't expecting to hit in this spot or to defensively be in the spot that he is at the beginning of the season. But he stepped in behind the plate. He's been very solid. Now fills that two role for him.
Ooh, Wilkie just got plunked.
Funny
may come back breaking ball after that. He elevates the fastball against Wilkie to swing through it. You could throw the breaking ball out of the same spot, see if you can get a swing and miss. And this one, Sanchez overthrows, gets a little bit quick, tries to power it at the top part of the zone. Ball sails on him, and that one stings.
In the dugout, they're saying, now it's a party. Now we're ready to rock.
Not standing on first base, just wearing one.
Yeah, that's right. Hit by pitch is always a better play when it's not happening to you.
Yeah, they've got a guy who can rock right now stepping in. Here he is, the right fielder, Seth Beer. Beer, first pitch swinging. Likely going to get out of play. Indeed, it will. He hit his 13th home run of the season on Sunday. Had two hits in the game. Tough one Saturday for Beer, though. Reaches base often, but he was 0 for 6 on Saturday. That broke a 23-game streak where he reached base safely.
See somewhat of a shift in the outfield, somewhat of a shift on the infield, pushing all the way over the shortstop, Salvatore, not on the second base side, but close.
That could be two, probably will be, played by the third baseman in the shift. So Mendoza starts it. And they get one as Beer beats it out at first.
So Mendoza playing into that shift to third baseman, and it's a changeup. You can see Beer get all the way out in front of it. And this is not easy. It's not hit hard, but it's spinning all over the place because it went right off the end of the bat. Beer does not run great, but that ball wasn't hit very hard. Mendoza couldn't get out of his glove right away. You can see Bornegal trying to get out of the way and get out of his glove as fast as he could. He's not hit quite hard enough to turn two. But even into the shift, you're not going to see Beer hit too many ground balls to the left side, except if you see that. A cue shot that he's out in front of a changeup. It just hit right off the end of the bat.
So Chris Williams steps in. 14th home run of the year came in yesterday's win.
Think about that, guys. That's a weird play. That's the third baseman flipping to the shortstop because of the shift. You just wonder, how much is that practiced?
I would venture to say not often.
Not as much as, you know, I think in college baseball, we're just starting to experience the shift. So this is what normally a shortstop does to a second baseman. We have a third baseman doing it to a shortstop. And it wasn't super clean.
Well, you're right. I mean, Salvatore, I said Bornegal the first time. I took my eyes off it. But Salvatore, I mean, that's a move that, I mean, he's never going to make. I mean, he may have to do that three times a whole season.
Right.
Maybe.
Maybe, yeah.
Coming
for sure.
From that side of the bag.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Williams tied for the ACC lead in home runs this season with Kyle McCann of Georgia Tech.
Getting this kid healthy and back, what a deal. Just a season changer for Clemson. Williams can really hit.
Full count now to Williams. Again, the importance of the first inning for Sands. It's the inning that's really, really stuck him over the course of this season. So Beer over at first after grounding into the fielder's choice. A little breaking ball. Williams had to wait on it. Fouled it off. Clemson with a 13 State 13 inning win on Saturday. Clemson bounced back with the second game. Beer on the move. That is ball four. Now they're on first and second here in the bottom of the first as Grayson Bird, the DH, will step to the plate.
You look at it, KP. I mean, Sand's stuff is, it's the real deal. I mean, that's a firm fastball. That's a real breaking ball, but just the managing the game part, not so much.
No, and the changeups look good. I mean, he's thrown a few right-on-right changeups. You got the out to Seth Beer with the changeup there. You can't argue with the three pitches that he's got. It's just consistency and the ability to get ahead of guys and finish them. He's already hit one and walked one here in the first.
Did get his money's worth on the hit-by-pitch, though. Give credit out.
That was not a crazy
pull. He spent the whole dollar on that.
First pitch to Bird. And that's strike one. Grayson Bird, like Beer, like Williams, also homered on Sunday for Clemson. That was a game that saw seven home runs all told. For Bird, it was his eighth. His dad, longtime pitcher in the bigs, Paul Bird. Got a little crossed up, but still called for strike number two, 0-2. What do we see here, KP?
Well, I think we saw a ball called a strike is what it looked like. He's crossed up. And
that is outside, yeah. Yes, indeed. The folks in orange and purple not happy with that call.
There's a lot going on there.
Yeah, and you got to think for home plate umpire, when that glove's moving all over the place, obviously that's catching the eyes of Morris Hodges a little too. That one's too good. That one's too good, 0-2.
Oh, so you got
a
right.
Gift. I mean, you got a gift, got you to 0-2. And that was piped.
21 pitches already. Not what Florida State needed pitch count-wise. Wow.
What do you think Mike Martin would like to get out of him, KP?
I think 75 and 80. If he could go at 80 and look up and Cole Sands is trotting off the mound in the fifth inning, I think he'd take that the whole time.
Yeah, but to your point, Runes, 80 isn't coming to the fifth inning at this rate.
Yeah, you have both clubs have absolutely compromised bullpens right now. You have an extra inning game and went to the bullpen in game two as well. It's definitely all hands on deck, but there has been a lot of pitchers thrown already in this series.
Now the 1-2 coming to Bird. 2-2. So Seth Beer standing over on second after grounding into a fielder's choice. Chris Williams over at first after he walked. As you see, the winningest coach in the history of NCAA baseball, Mike Martin. 1,976 wins here in his 39th season at his alma mater. Bird sharply hit first base. Applin easily makes the play. And we are through one. He labored. It was not easy. But in the end, no damage done. For Cole Sands and the Noles, we're off to the second. Welcome back to Clemson. So you see a pitch that looked outside, called strike two, just a couple of minutes ago to Grayson Bird. In between innings, Monty Lee, Clemson third-year head coach, letting it be heard by home plate umpire Morris Hodges. We are assuming it was about that pitch. We saw nothing else that would evidently upset him.
So I would say this. I would assume it was about the pitch. It seemed to have been that. I'll also give Morris Hodges some credit right there.
Yes.
Because he got chewed on pretty good.
Agreed.
And there's a lot of guys that would have gone back after Monty Lee right there. Morris Hodges is a vet. He's been around for a long time. He realized he missed the pitch. Monty Lee goes out there. He gets his money worth, and everybody's all right.
And Monty Lee is very level-headed with umpires. I mean, he's not a guy that you see losing his mind often, but he's clearly upset.
Cal Raleigh, the Florida State catcher, staring at a 1-2 situation right now. Raleigh has started 171 consecutive games. Guys, 168 at catcher. Raleigh, well hit. Nearly played by Sam Hall, the freshman who, because of the shift, was on the left side of second base. But that goes for the game's first base hit.
Sometimes the shift giveth and sometimes it takes away.
That's right.
And this is one to where if you're playing straight up at shortstop, it's going to be hit straight to Logan Davidson. But instead, Sam Hall, the freshman second baseman, pushed over to the shortstop side. Raleigh leans on one, but Hall has to go backhand, just his seventh start of the year for Seth Hall. So he hasn't been out there very much, and he definitely hasn't been on that side of the bag very much.
And that is a sales job for coaches. You have to sell pitchers on the shift, and that doesn't help it. That's not going on the brochure.
So with Raleigh on first, Drew Mendoza, the third baseman, steps in. By the way, Raleigh over at first in this series is now 6-for-10. He's been a tough out, to say the least. As for Mendoza, he's 2-for-10 in the series. Through March 21st, Drew Mendoza was hitting .450. That's through two series in conference play. He's down at the moment to .310.
Shocking to me, guys, because he's a big physical kid with an approach. He's not just sit and spin and look to yank home runs. Wow.
There's the numbers.
Yep. It's not pretty.
No, and I think one of the things that gets lost a little bit in the college game is the number of games in total. So, I mean, that's a bad few weeks, a bad few weekends. The reality is Mendoza can still really hit.
And you're hitting 440. You're 6'5", 225. Mendoza's a kid that no one expected to get to college.
Exactly.
We all expected him to be a first-round draft pick out of high school. So he is getting extra special treatment from pitchers.
A 140-point drop in the span of 25 games.
You'll start changing your superstitions now.
This was an all-college World Series guy a year ago as the pitch gets by Wilkie and scampering to scoring position at second base now as well.
I will tell you guys, that is pure baseball instincts because Cal Raleigh runs like a catcher with the gear on. He is not in there for foot speed. That's the only tool he doesn't have. But
for the record, he is one for one in stolen base attempts.
Speed kills.
That does go down as a wild pitch if you're scoring at home, and I'm not sure why you wouldn't be. As Mendoza, swing and a miss. Second strikeout of the game for Higginbotham. So Florida State picked before the season to win the Atlantic, win the league in general. Right now the Noles sit 3.5 behind Clemson, who is two games clear of NC State right now. Clemson and Florida State both play non-conference series next weekend. They've only got three conference games left. What that means is if Florida State does not win tonight, they cannot win the Atlantic Division. Though their last season, a series in 2 weeks, is against NC State. So, again, more opportunity like this game tonight to boost the RPI and potentially end up with a top eight national seed.
And, guys, conference finish matters. That is something the committee always harps on, is conference finish.
Rare start tonight for the man in the batter's box right now. Junior DH, Skyler Frey, just his fourth start of the season, hitting 235. Did have an RBI single and a bases loaded walk yesterday, however. Raleigh standing on second. Higginbotham checks him out.
If Raleigh goes on to steals third, he's going to point up here. Right. He's going to point right at you.
If he steals third, I'll run into the field and take his helmet.
Oh, tried to bend it around the outside edge of the plate. 1-2.
It's a pretty good pitch there now. It's not an easy one to take, and if you're Higginbotham, you can throw this one back-to-back and take your chances. One of them's going to get called for a strike. It's probably a little bit down, but it's not down by much.
It is a good looping curveball.
Not making friends in Clemson, South Carolina so far, Morris Hodges.
You're not going to tell me that should have been called a strike.
Yeah, that's a ball. As a former hitter, you got to.
You are not going to tell me that should have been called a strike.
That's right.
Tell you want it.
Gray area, Daria. That's gray area.
Uh-huh. Now 2-2 to Frey.
I'll tell you how you know both pitchers have good stuff. The catchers are running around like a Frisbee football game right now. And this is – you don't see catchers hopping around like that very often.
That's what you want?
No. You want it because the stuff's really good, but you'd prefer the catcher not have to dive to catch it.
Stuff is better when it's in the zone.
Yes. Well said.
That's in the dirt. Gets by Wilkie, and over to third goes Raleigh. Well, now he can't steal third, guys. So much for that.
But his speed affected that play, Dory. I think that was clear.
And now we're going to have a meeting of the four umpires. There's Raleigh. We're showing the wheels.
And just to be clear, who cares if you can run if you're a catcher? It's not
Thank
the job.
Right, exactly.
I'm with you. Who cares?
It's another wild pitch there for Higginbotham.
He's got two home runs on the weekend.
Yeah.
No, he's doing all right. Yeah.
All right, Coach, what do you got here?
Yeah, first of all, you're addressing him as sir because that's the all-time wins leader. Is he saying the catcher can't hear, maybe?
They're going to go look at something.
Could be the technology, potentially.
They're going to go review something.
Let's look at this. I'm not going to hide this. One of you two is going to have to tell me what in the world they could be looking at right now.
I think it's got to be the hitter. I think there has to be something with the movement of the hitter as to whether or not he was interfering with a throw. Other than that, I don't know what else. I mean, you can't go back and review whether or not it's a balk.
Right.
Clearly, it wouldn't have been right there. There's nothing base runner-wise that it could have been. And potentially, it's whether or not they hit him.
All right, let's take a look, see what we can see here. It's got to be whether it hit him, right?
Yeah, watch his right toe. But watch the way the ball goes further up than it does normally. Watch this.
Well, that's hard to see.
Top of the shoe.
I don't know that it did. You think it did?
I did.
I mean, immediately Frey pointed down to his foot.
I do, but I think it's more because of the way that the ball bats.
Yep.
I mean, usually that looked like a fastball to me. So if you're going to throw a fastball on that side of the plate, it's usually going to stay down. That's why it's almost impossible for a catcher to block that pitch. So if you don't hear anything, you have to go more on trajectory of the ball after it gets to that point. And to me, it looks like it goes further up than it normally would.
Just to confirm, yes, indeed, you can review whether a hitter is hit by the pitch.
That ball's usually going to skip.
Yep.
I mean, if you're missing with a fastball, it's going to stay low. And you can even see the glove right there. And I think that's one reason why. And it's somewhat of a telltale. For Wilkie, he's used to that ball. If it's a fastball, watch where his glove is when he goes to make that play. To where it usually skips, like it's a short hop into it.
I'm going to take the other side. I don't think that hit him, but what do I know? Here's what I do know. If it's determined that it did hit Frey, that means Raleigh heads back to second. And all of a sudden, we might get another shot at seeing him swipe it back.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, to your point, KP, umpire's sound is such an underrated part of umpiring, and it just didn't get enough cleat right there to probably make much of a sound.
His right foot does not move. If you're getting hit by a pitch, I'm assuming it's going to move.
I think it hit him. I think it hit him just on the bounce of the baseball.
I would tell you this story. The Florida State hitter is taught, hold your ground. They are taught not to move. I don't know you can overturn that, though, right?
I don't know that you can overturn it. But if I had to go one way or another.
We're about to find out. The determination is that it did not hit him. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean call stands is what it says. It does not mean that it was confirmed. It does not mean that definitively they know it didn't hit him. It just means there's nothing conclusive to say we need to change.
So I would tell you with that one, if they had called it a hit by pitch, I don't think they would overturn it.
He's probably going to first. Yeah. Exactly.
But I think it's one that when you look at it and it's moving at that speed, you can't tell for sure either way.
So call stands. Raleigh over at third. 3-2 pitch coming to Skyler Frey. Now, did he hold up? He did. They quick check down at first, and first base on Thomas Newsom says he did not go around. So Florida State's got him on the corners now and one away for Reese Albert. I was looking at Monty Lee right after it happened. Not a lot of reaction from him. But there's got to be a little concern with what he's seen from Higginbotham here early, isn't there?
Yeah, it looked great in the first. I mean, he went bang, bang, bang. I think it was 11-pitch first inning to make it look easy. Raleigh smokes one. He gets a strikeout to Mendoza on a good breaking ball. And now Fry standing on first base, but you're still one pitch away from getting out of this thing.
And I'll tell you guys, Wilkie is really fighting it back there. Yeah, I mean, it must speak to Higginbotham having really hot stuff tonight because Wilkie's struggling with him.
And now he runs it 2-0 to Reese Albert, center fielder hitting 260, but also having a huge series, 5-for-9 with 2 home runs in the series for Albert, as now we've got a meeting at the mound and a chat with Higginbotham.
Andrew C. right there. For me, KP, one of the great pitching coaches out there. Think about Clemson had to replace every start from last year. That's unheard of.
So one of the things that they did in the fall because of that is instead of playing 9-inning games, they'd play 2 fives. And they played 2 fives because they wanted to start 6 guys over the course of 3 straight days and honestly see who could get deeper into a fall game and then ultimately come out of fall and say, okay, these are the 3, 4, 5 guys that we think fit the starter's role. These are the guys that don't. And it was because of that, because they just didn't have any starting innings coming back.
How about that for sleepless nights? We have 0 starts back.
Check over on Frey at first. 2 stolen bases and 3 tries on the season for the junior, who is DHing tonight. Again, just his 4th start of the season. Meanwhile, Albert steps in, well hit, second base. Clemson may dodge a bullet. Hall to Davidson over to Williams. and they get out of a mess. 4-6-3 double play to end the Seminole threat in the second.
It's a bullet. Albert hit it right in the middle, but right at the freshman. Hall flipped to Davidson. Plenty of time to finish the double play. Two scoreless to start from Higginbotham.
Wednesday night baseball, Red Sox, Yankees. That probably says all you need to hear. They play the second game of their three-game set. David Price and Masahiro Tanaka facing off on the mound. That is Wednesday, 7 Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app. As we move into the bottom of the second.
Don't the Red Sox have a pretty good outfielder that played college baseball a couple years ago, KP?
Two of them.
That's right.
Jackie Bradley, Ben attending. Mookie Betts signed out of high school.
Yeah, Mookie Betts has had a pretty good run there.
Aaron Judge, a former Fresno State star who's done okay.
Yeah, it's done okay. Kyle Peterson, Mike Rooney, Dari Noka with you here. In Clemson, South Carolina, third baseman Patrick Cromwell leading things off in a scoreless game to this point. 6'2 senior from Costa Mesa, California. Couple of runs batted in yesterday's win for Clemson. Went 2-for-4. He's down 0-2. That pitch looked to go behind him from Sands.
Clemson has always done a nice job recruiting the nation, and Cromwell from that really good California junior college system. So many great players have come out of there.
Kind of runs away from that changeup a little bit. When it's been in the zone, it's been pretty good. It's just been inconsistent, and the misses have been all over the place. That one kind of flares high arm side. He's tugged a few of them to the glove side where he hasn't got through them. But if it's over the plate, he's going to get some outs with it.
Ooh. Little in, and the count runs full now to Cromwell.
But there's a lot to dream on there, guys. I mean, even that fastball in right there, that's an unhittable pitch if it's in the strike zone.
There's an inside fastball, strike three.
You know, I like that they doubled up there, too. They came right back with it. We talked about the influence of the college game at the major league level. So opening day rosters this year, over 45%. We're getting close to 50. There are four-year college players. You throw in the junior college players, it's above 50%. And remember, this includes the international side. If you just look at drafted players and take the international side out of it, it's 70% that come from the college ranks between four-year colleges and the junior college level. The college impact at the major league side is going to continue to be important. Go ahead, Rins.
Yeah, it's the whole thing, too, guys, right? I mean, you get an education. You grow up as a person. But I think the thing that gets missed is the baseball development's outstanding. You play in a game of this magnitude, you're getting better as a player.
Hey, Buck Showalter has talked about this, manager of the Orioles, about how getting guys from conferences like this, the ACC, the SEC, where you're playing in big-time environments, as you push them through a system, the environments don't bother you as much because you've already been in big environments.
There are so many great environments, too, around college baseball. This place here, averaging over 51 fans a game as Wharton fouls it off. That's good for sixth in the country, tops in the ACC.
On pace to break the all-time season attendance record here at Doug Kingsmore. I love the setting, man.
Oh, yeah, it's awesome. And you know, Monty Lee's got this going here, Dari. I mean, two straight regionals they've hosted. Looks like they're clearly going to host a third one this year. It's happening here.
There's strike two now to Drew Wharton, the center fielder. Swanee, Georgia native. They call him very steady. Batting average a little down, .233, but you put him in that seven spot, he'll give you what he's got every single day as he fouls that off, so we'll stay 2-2.
Wharton is such a Clemson player where they're 6'2 and athletic. Maybe it's the uniform, guys. Can I get some of these Clemson pants?
Pants and the white shoes?
It's so good.
Make you look a little quicker.
Can they make me look 6'2 is the big question.
If they can, get me one, would you?
That's right. We'll have two.
Yes,
two, please.
I'm not going to lie, though.
Throw pinstripes on.
I like the white. I love the purples.
Yes, those are big time. Yes.
Those are some of the greatest uniforms in all of college. I think their purples and Ole Miss's Baby Blues.
Florida State Golds are pretty solid,
yeah.
too.
Yes.
Yeah.
Camera friendly there, too, by the way. Not their first TV game.
No, it's not. Now it runs full from Sands to Wharton. So the pitch count continues to climb at 37 now for Sands. Swing and a miss. Outside fastball. Good enough to get Wharton. And that's the second strikeout of the night for Cole Sands, the junior.
Fastball from Sands, and we've seen it's kind of gotten hit and miss. This one's probably out of the zone, probably ball four. But when you have to dial up for the velo like you do with Sands, Wharton starts the hands on a fastball that he just can't get to. Back-to-back strikeouts for Cole Sands.
So with two down, Clemson brings in the second baseman, six-foot freshman Sam Hall. Hall, ground ball into the hole. Salvatore deep in the hole. Not going to get enough on the throw. That'll go down as a single for Hall. Clemson's first base hit of the night.
This is a kid they're excited about. Freshman who has not had very many starts this year for Sam Hall, just hasn't really had a chance. Now gets one because of some injuries. Grayson Bird not able to go in the infield yet, so the freshman gets in there. But when we talked to Monty Lee earlier today, he said he's probably the best athlete in the field. He can really one run. We want to keep him in the middle of the infield. And has made the most of his chance. Just a sixth start today, but he's hitting above 300 on base percentage, close to 400, and he can really run.
So Hall over at first, and he's on the move. Throw down to second. Oh, it was in time from Raleigh. One of the best in the country at pegging base runners. And just like that, the inning comes to an end. Robert Jolly faces one pitch. He will lead off in the third.
Cal Raleigh's having some kind of junior year, doing it with the bat, also doing it with the arm right there. He gone right there. No score, headed to the third.
Top three we go. Florida State, Clemson here in this rubber match of this three-game set. As you see, Mike Martin winning his coach in the history of NCAA baseball. First pitch swinging from the shortstop, Salvatore. Easy play by Cromwell over at third. One pitch, one out. Mike Martin, two nights ago, became the all-time wins leader, passing Augie Garrido. Mike Rooney talked to him before the game. What was it like afterwards?
Well, I got some calls from people that left the program early. And it really made me feel good that they would call back and say they enjoyed their years here at Florida State. And it just, it's about teaching. And you know that, Michael, having been a coach. And it's about young men growing up. It's about people that made it to the big leagues, hearing from Terry Kennedy and J.D. Drew and the outstanding players that have been in our program. And I'm just naming a couple. Just very proud to be a part of Florida State, and I must admit I've never been through anything like this.
For sure.
He is there are not many more fun conversations around the sport than one with Mike Martin. Bornegal, look at that. Shift deep into the shallow grass in the outfield. Throw to first by Hall is in time. Little collision between Rafael Bornegal and Chris Williams. Two away is the result.
I'll tell you guys, this is how I tell people all the time. You want to know how good of a person Mike Martin is? I think in my career as an assistant coach, I was 1-8 versus Florida State, and I still swear by the guy. I mean, I remember first time we ever played them. There's a pro shift exhibit right there. We go to Florida State in 99, and we get swept. And I talked to my dad after the series. And my dad says, how'd it go? Remember, this is pre-internet. Well, there is no internet for my dad still. But so I said, Mike Martin remembered my name after the series. And then he's like, but how'd the games go? I was like, I don't know.
I don't really care.
We were swept. But I'm telling you, this guy is a presence, just an incredible person.
You just think over the years of how many lives that guy's impacted. And it's not just, I mean, clearly, it's not just the people that played for him. I mean, it's anybody that's that's had the chance to talk to him for a while. You get him talking about golf, and he'll stand there and talk about golf for an hour, too. And it's he loves talking about that. He loves talking about his grandkids, and he loves talking about this game. What he usually doesn't like talk about is himself.
That's right. That's
I mean, he'll veer off of that as fast as you possibly can.
Well, Mark Davidson, Logan's dad, who played here at Clemson and in the major leagues for a while with the Twins, won a World Series, was talking about a story he had with Mike Martin. I'll share that with you in just a moment as his young son, Logan, makes the catch to end the third. Three up, three down there from Higginbotham. He needed one of those. We go to the bottom of the third. Still scoreless at Clemson. Mike Martin, two nights ago, sets the all-time wins record. NCAA baseball, and the tweets were rolling in. Jameis Winston, of course, Buccaneer quarterback who played baseball for him. Congrats, 11. Willie Taggart. Look at the names. TCU head coach Jim Schlossnagel. And then Texas with a classic tweet. As you see, of course, he passed the record held by Augie Garrido, the late Augie Garrido in Texas baseball. Congratulations, Mike Martin. We know Augie would be proud. Incredibly classy gesture from Texas as that ball up the middle. For a leadoff single here in the bottom of the third, the left fielder Robert Jolly standing on first. So mentioned off in that last inning, Mark Davidson, who played at the Bigs, played at Clemson. His son, Logan, is the shortstop for Clemson. Talking about how you remember Mike Martin. He said it was third year of Martin. We're talking, what, early
82, 82.
Florida State's playing here. Florida State ties the game and then hits a gapper to the right center field wall. Now, the throw comes in hot. It ends up getting over the head of the third baseman. Well, wisely, Davidson, who was playing left at the time, had come in to back up the throw, and he makes the play. He said Mike Martin walked up to him, patted him on the backside, and said, "That's a great play, young man. That's a great play." He goes, all these great things happened to me in Major League Baseball, wins a ring in 87 with Minnesota. He remembers that as much as anything. And that's this kind of story that Mike Martin has given people. As that ball from Logan, his son, deep to left, goodbye! What do you think, Pops?
Guys, I'm not sure, Dari, Mike Martin's going to appreciate that play by a Davidson as much as the backup. But this kid's a future star, guys. That's elevated by Sands, fastball. Davidson using the whole field. That is a star. I'm thinking he would appreciate the backup so much more. That is awesome.
Number nine on the season for Logan Davidson, and it's 2-0 Tigers.
So for his pops, he's now got a classmate, too. And that was I love this story. My. Mark Davidson comes back. So 1982 played here at Clemson. Now you saw underneath him student assistant coach, and that's exactly what he is.
57 years old.
Not for much longer, because we've already taken finals and everything would be done. But he had a year to finish up. So think about this. You get to come back to school in your 50s. And you get to watch that. You get to coach your son every day in the position that he's in. And talking to Mark about it before the game was pretty cool just to have an experience. And I'm not sure that he really expected he would get a chance to have. I mean, that's about as rare as we hear in this game.
Oh, there is no doubt. Look at this. This was in the 80s that he played there, of course. And there's Mark playing.
Still the long white slacks. They've had those forever. Yeah.
Ballpark looked a little different then, as he explained. So KP, he comes back. He's got a year of school, takes the summer classes, then fall. Clemson has what they call the Tiger Trust. If you leave early, you get drafted, you want to go play your sport, they will pay for you to come back and finish college, whenever that is. He's 57 years old, and he comes back. He's the student assistant coach, essentially. Not grad assistant, but undergrad assistant. 1 year of classes left. He and Logan have a father-son rivalry. Grades. Says Logan's never made a B. 4.0 student through 2 years to this point. 4.0 student. He said he hadn't made a B either. He's got all four. Four of his five grades are in for this last semester. Four A's. He's waiting on one more to get his. He's got his history degree. But the class
is family and kinship. And he doesn't know if it's an A or a B, and he needs to know that grade.
And
so
the professor's
can see if he and Logan match up with all A's.
If that professor's listening, that's got to be an A. Like, you're about to change posterity in that family.
That's right. Forever. You want to talk about dinner room conversation. That gets a little bit different if Pops gets 1B in his senior year.
There's no doubt.
I think that is so cool.
Yes.
It is so cool to get a chance, one, to coach your son, which obviously we've seen plenty of times. Mike Martin coached his son, Mike Martin Jr., when he was at Florida State. But to do it in this way and to come back and finish your degree at the same time.
What a year for that family.
Oh, man. They're going to have a good year next year, too.
That's right.
1-2, now 2-2 to Seth Beer. And he did. He wanted to point out, if you tell the story, I don't want any pressure on that on my professor to give me an A, right? Well, the professor, he says, is a big baseball fan, and he usually sits somewhere out in the cheap seats. I might go with the guy in the light orange shirt on the right. I'm just guessing if I'm guessing a professor. I might go that guy.
That just looks like
I'm talking
a family
about?
And kinship professor.
Yes.
Is that what you're going
it does.
This?
He needs to get his laptop out and put an A down is what needs to happen.
Beer, ground ball, first base, played by Applin, steps on the bag, two down. But how cool is that? You're sitting here having a grade battle with your son. You're 57 years old, and it's who's going to make the first B? Nobody's made a B. How cool is that?
That is awesome. I think the dad's probably thinking, hey, he's going to maybe throw a couple Bs in there. I don't think Mark was thinking he had to go five A's to win that competition. The marker was set higher than expected.
Here's Williams. Williams walked back in the first. Tiger Trust, well done.
What a great program. I'll tell you, KP, as far as this game goes, Florida State's got Seth Beer all kinds of tied up. And that's going to put a little extra pressure on a Logan Davidson and a Chris Williams.
It is a lineup that has some length, though, when it comes to power. I mean, Clemson comes in third in the country with 71 home runs, now 72 after that swing by Davidson. I mean, they can quick strike you, and they've done it tonight.
Yeah. 1-2 coming from Sands. Popped up, and it'll cruise out of play.
But you can see why Sands was Friday night. I mean, he throws some pitches that you say to yourself, wow, that plays anywhere.
But you got to remember, I mean, he missed a few turns. And so he's still coming back. He missed 2 weeks, and you haven't thrown many bullpens because they shut him down for a little bit. Takes a little bit of time sometimes to get comfortable out there. But you said it earlier, Runes, and I'm all with you. I mean, from a professional side, there's a lot of things you can dream on with that right arm.
Yeah, the raw materials are tremendous.
Yep. That came in tight on Williams, 2-2. More on Davidson academics.
Uh-oh.
Logan's sister, Mark's daughter, Taylor. Tennis team at?
Cardinal.
Stanford.
Wow, go trees.
Yeah. I'd like to add her brother there, too, right now, I can tell you that.
She's out of the competition. She's been ruled ineligible for that competition for being too smart. She is not in the GPA competition.
She may have a B. I guess you could forgive it at Stanford, right?
I don't think you even go there.
No, you don't. But how about 57? He comes in for a year. Summer, fall, spring, all A's. Five classes in the spring, all A's.
That's impressive.
That's amazing. By the way, he still works out. You see the condition that man is in right now?
Yeah, that was 1-0 him when I was talking to him.
Yeah. As if his GPA wasn't putting us to shame enough. Come on.
You do that too?
Do you bleed or is there oil coming out of there?
He said, I said, how do you 50? How are you in this kind of shape? He said, I played my last game in Major League Baseball. A couple days later. So what can I do? I got to stay in shape. I'm not going to the park every day. He starts going to the YMCA. He goes 5 days a week to the Y and he's done it forever since then.
Wow.
How good is that?
That's really good. Need one of those memberships.
I don't have that one in my pocket.
And ball four, and what was a long at bat to Chris Williams. Second walk of the game for Williams.
So for Cole Sands, it was 24 pitches in the first, 16 in the second. So came into the inning at 40. Now we're over 20 in this one, 21 in the third inning alone. And remember, that pitch count for Sands is one thing to watch here today. Florida State's definitely going to keep an eye on it. They don't want him to go much beyond 80, 85, even though we're getting late into the season. Missed a few turns. They're working that arm strength back up.
But you said it, runs off the top. Bullpens have worked in 22 innings of play coming in this series. That ball will hit well to center by Grayson Bird, but how well? Not quite well enough. Albert back near the track to make the play. If there was a track in this park, that would be 2-0 Clemson after the Davidson home run. We'll chat with third-year head coach Monty Lee when we get you back. Dari Noka, Kyle Peterson, Mike Rooney with you in Clemson. 2-0 Tigers after the two-run home run from Logan Davidson, the shortstop, the sophomore, in the second. As we welcome in Clemson head coach Monty Lee. Coach, we appreciate you spending just a couple of minutes with us here. Well, he did it again. That is somebody special you've got standing over at short, isn't it?
Yeah, he's a special player, switch hitter, with power, can run, and not to mention he's a 4.0 student. So he represents us very well day in and day out. Very proud of Logan.
Hey, Monty, Seth Pierce had one of the great careers at Clemson, but he's a marked man on scouting reports. You can see that. What do you need from him as far as managing his at-bats?
You know, just to stay in the strike zone. I think the big key for him is not being overly aggressive. You know, sometimes he gets a little frustrated by it and, you know, tries to be a little bit too aggressive. He just needs to stay in the strike zone and do what he does.
Monty, we're getting in a home stretch now, and everybody's playing for national seeds and hosting sites and all that, and clearly you're right in the middle of the mix. When you look at your club, is there anything that gives you concern as you head into the postseason?
No. I mean, to be honest with you, I feel really good about our club. Our starting pitching's been solid. Our bullpen's really good. It's the best defensive club we'd have since I've been here at Clemson, and we've got some power. You know, we've got some guys that can hit the ball out of the ballpark. So, you know, we got a good club. We just got to keep playing good baseball.
Monty, we appreciate your time. Best of luck getting out of this one.
All right, thank you.
Luke's going to try to score from first. The throw home is in time, but he beat it. He got there first. That, I have a hunch they may look at, as Applin sent one into the left field corner with Luke on first after the error. Mike Martin Jr. sending Luke from first. Let's look at it again. Robert Jolly picks it up, throws to his cutoff Davidson. The throw home is in time, it appears, but that's a good call.
Yep.
And it's 2-1.
Real good call. Thomas Newsom, the first base umpire, there on the rotation right there, and you could see that front foot of Luke got all the way in there. Mike Martin Jr. getting a little aggressive here.
Yeah, nobody out. I know the head coach pretty well, but that is a no-no if you're the third base coach, getting somebody thrown out with nobody out. That would be a family conversation, I believe, in this program.
Well done by Jackson Luke to get in, and it's a 2-1 game. Nobody out.
And you got
Applin on second.
You got a problem here. I mean, Cal Raleigh's maybe the hottest hitter in this series right now. So it's not getting easier for Higginbotham.
Higginbotham cruised through that third. Three up, three down, but a tougher start here in the fourth. And now 2-1.
Yeah, Raleigh now 6-for-10 in the series, 2 home runs.
That'll work. First base open. He cannot get a pitch to hit here, right here, KP.
I think it's off the plate, but I like the spot.
Yes.
I like the surprise, because even though the fastball has been a little bit misfire sometimes, his best fastballs today from Higginbotham have been in that spot. When he goes glove side, tries to stick it in on the hands of the right-handed hitters.
You see Applin's back to us at second. That's his 15th double. Good for third in the ACC. That's tops on the Seminole team.
I'll tell you, for me, KP, what you're trying to do here is you're going in and you're telling Higginbotham, hey, if you're going to miss, hit him. It's in and in off. Because if you miss middle in right here, it's 3-2.
Oh, did he need that one?
Tell you what, Cal Raleigh's got a really good arm, or excuse me, a really good eye. He's walked 41 times over the course of the season. This looks into me because of the glove movement. A lot of times when you see a catcher bring that ball back, and you can see the movement right there by Kyle Wilkie to bring that ball back, it looked like it was in off the plate. I love the pitch. I think it's exactly where you want to throw it because you may steal a strikeout, and he did right there, but you can see the reaction of Raleigh. He thought it was in, and it looked a little in.
Strikeout number three tonight for Higginbotham. Here's Mendoza. One of those strikeout victims. This time, the slow ground ball. Hall was playing into right field. No shot, really, when he's moving that way, playing from that far back. So now they're on the corners with one away, and that does go as a hit for Mendoza, who's now 3-for-12 in the series.
I'll tell you guys, this is a nice job of staying under control by the Clemson defense. Right here, you see Hall is in that shift position. But remember, there's a runner in scoring position who's on the move right now. If you're Hall and you throw that away, great job by Williams to come off the base and vacate first base. You throw that away, that's a run.
So now Applin stands on third. Mendoza over at first for Skyler Frey, who walked in the second. A check on Mendoza.
It's interesting, KP, for me, Higginbotham, he has two pitches, fastball into the right-handers and breaking ball to the lefties. I think you're good. You're going to at least get through the lineup twice, yeah. But it's just a little inconsistent with those two offerings.
Fastball missed, 1-0.
I mean, the one thing they have worked on, and we haven't seen it tonight, and he hasn't thrown it much in the game, is that changeup. So something soft that'll go away from the barrel when a right-hand hitter is up. But I'm with you. I mean, when he lands the fastball glove side and the breaking ball, when it starts over the zone and falls down out, are two quality pitches.
And you can see it's a fastball spray. You know, his fastball command can be real scattershot.
But I do think, sorry, Runes, if you're going to scout and report against him, if you're a right-handed hitter, I'd eliminate the outer third.
Yes.
From a fastball standpoint, because he hasn't shown the ability to consistently be there, and you can cheat on something in. Because if he's got to make a fastball or make a pitch with a fastball, he wants to make a glove side.
Yep. You just hate those words coming out of your mouth as a hitting coach. Look to turn and burn.
There's a strike to Frey. And that's been Higginbotham's story this season. Very tough on lefties, but righties can and often do have success against it. Frey once again making just his fourth start of the season. But an opportunity here to tie the game or put his team ahead. 2-2.
That's pretty.
It is. It is. And it wouldn't surprise me if he tries to go back to the exact same spot. That's the comfort zone.
Yeah, I mean, why not? Just jam it in there.
Yeah.
No hitter likes that. Mickey Mantle didn't like that.
Is that true?
I'm telling you, you ask any hitter, hey, he's just going to pound with a hot fat. Yeah, I know he's in Oklahoma. That hit a chord with you, Dari, didn't it?
That's
I went to the home state.
Anything, Mickey, I'm good. That ball fouled off.
You know who did like it? Did you watch Sunday Night Baseball all last night? Did you see Chris Bryant keep that ball fair?
Oh, I did not see.
Fastball probably 3 or 4 inches in and off the plate that was moving in towards his barrel, and a 6'5 dude kept it fair and hit it about 440 feet down the left field line. That is not an easy thing to do.
He is so
good.
Was
that in between rain delays?
Yeah.
Plural.
Here comes the 2-2 to Frey. Mendoza! Got a little twitch there and nearly got caught by Higginbotham, but he gets back.
If you're picked there and you didn't dive, boys, that's the longest walk in the dug back to the dugout that exists in baseball. Oh, boy.
you got to get dirty. And a swing and a miss. He blew a fastball right by Frey.
Four straight trying to go to the exact same spot. Got himself back in the count. Bang, bang with two fastballs in the inside part of the plate. Then tried to come back in. Frey fouled one off, and then this time sticks it again. Glove side. Watch the glove. It doesn't hardly move. That one does look like a strike, whether it's swung on a miss. But I mean, even the misses, when he tries to go there, if he misses glove side, he's just missing off. Close enough that he can get a call.
Because Chris Bryant's not in this game, boys. You know, it's like if I'm Higginbotham, it's fastball into you righties. What are you going to do about it?
So here's Reese Albert, the second or the center fielder, I beg your pardon. That's a strike one to start him off.
This is fun. We got two guys with arm talent in this game.
We do, at least for a little while. Pitch counts on both of them are getting up there, huh? Breaking ball. That was five straight fastballs, right, KP? He'd thrown, and then he just drops that beauty in. He's 0-2.
And that, again, is the same side he wants to throw.
Yep.
And he wants to consistently throw everything on that side of the plate. See Albert, the lefty, just climbing on top of that plate, try to keep the outside corner away.
Folks in the building wanted it. They're not going to get it. Now, Mendoza just casually steps his way towards second.
Yeah, the way just the pitches Higginbotham's making right now, if you're Clemson, you're not bothering with Mendoza. You're trusting Higginbotham right here.
That does go as a steal for Mendoza. No throw down, but it is his third steal of the season. So now a base hit could put Florida State ahead if Albert can come through, but he's down 1-2. Breaking ball, and it got him. Strikeout for Frey. Then Higginbotham gets Albert, and they stay ahead 2-1.
Back-to-back strikeouts, three in the inning for Jake Higginbotham, who made pitches when he really had to here. Barrett fastballs on the inside part of the plate to the righty, then finishes Albert off with a breaking ball right here. Gave up one, but Clemson still leads it 2-1. And the whole world's gonna know my name. Are you ready?
Back in Clemson, we remind you, we've got an ESPN Plus matinee matchup for you Tuesday. Twins and Cardinals play in the second game of their two-game set before both teams head west. 1:15 Eastern, Jake Odorizzi facing Carlos Martinez. It's also streaming live on the ESPN app, so start that free trial of ESPN Plus right now. Why don't you? Good to have you with us here in Clemson, South Carolina. Mike Rooney, Kyle Peterson, Dari Noka with you in a 2-1 Clemson lead as we are into the bottom of the fourth, rubber game of a three-game series. Patrick Cromwell swings and misses at the breaking ball, and he's quickly down 0-2 against Cole Sands. Change up, I beg your pardon.
That one's got the makings of a good pitch.
Yes, it does.
And it's inconsistent right now. Ooh. And he just went back-to-back with it. I think that's the one thing. So if you're a scout looking at Sands, you're not necessarily looking at a 480 ERA. You're looking at what the gun tells you. You're looking at consistency on the fastball and the breakable. And then is the third pitch, does it have the makings of being a plus pitch? He went back-to-back, and it does. It doesn't have a ton of sink, but it's got enough. The velocity difference is solid. I mean, the velocity difference is 12, 13 miles an hour. I like that one.
And Cromwell's an older hitter who's a senior who's had a lot of at-bats, and he missed that by a ton. That tells you a lot.
There's another one.
Drew Wharton steps in. By the way, Cromwell now struck out both of his times to the plate tonight. Wharton struck out back in the second.
I love this, KP. Like, you find a pitch and you're grooving it, just go.
That ball hit to right field. Tailing towards the line. Play made by Stephen Wells, the senior out there for Florida State. And just like that, we've got two away.
Calling pitches is so thankless, but for me, guys, if you've got, it's like in golf, you got a club like a 7-iron that you're pure in it, keep hitting it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that's one of the things I remember. It was fall baseball, I think, my freshman year, and I was afraid to throw three changeups in a row. And at the time, Dean Stotts was our pitching coach and said, well, if it works, why would you stop?
Yes.
I mean, if they force you to do something different, that's fine. But make them make some kind of an adjustment. There's another changeup right there from Sands. And I like it. You can do it against right-handers. You can do it against left-handers. I remember facing Dante Bichette when he was with the Rockies. And every at-bat that he, like two or three at-bats I faced him, but I threw the changeup in the inside part of the plate both times. He almost killed somebody in the first row down the third baseline twice, but I had him 0-2. Because I didn't think he could keep the pitch fair. Now, the problem was I couldn't finish him off. So it was what happened next that caused some issues.
Yeah, what did happen next?
I don't know, but yeah. I know I didn't strike him out.
That wasn't only a Kyle Peterson problem, by the way.
No, he got a few.
Yeah, he hit a lot hard. In that ballpark especially. My God, I mean, those teams, Bichette, Larry Walker, Vinny Castillo, right? Ooh. Oh. That thing was coming right back our way. We'll be thankful for the net.
Isn't it amazing, though? Like, so Sands is grooving with the changeup, and then next thing you know, the fastball and the curveball are on it.
Yeah.
Just that confidence starts to happen, and this has been a tough inning to hit against him.
I do think the one thing with the changeup, too, is it forces you to slow down a little bit. And so you can get over the fastball a little bit more. It can get that momentum back. And he cruised right here. Gets a strikeout with back-to-back changeups. Fly ball to right. Then the strikeout of the freshman, Sam Hall. That's the best inning that Cole Sands has had today. Well, they needed this. They needed an efficient inning. And they needed a 1-2-3 inning. So strikeout on the changeup the first time, this time on the breaking ball. Solid inning for Cole Sands.
He broke the record two nights ago, all-time wins leader in NCAA baseball history. Mike Rooney spoke with him before the game, asked him, what would you write in a letter to your younger self?
Enjoy every minute, because it's something that you'll always look back on, and you never want to do something that you'll regret. And I'm sure there has been a number of things that I regret. I just don't try to think about them.
That is so Mike Martin. So 11, as everybody calls him. 8-9-1 due up for Florida State. Salvatore Bornegal and Stephen Wells at the top of the order. Salvatore popped up to third his first time up.
Look at that stat. And crazy. Just think about that for a minute. 50-plus wins, 24 of his last 38 seasons. 50-plus wins.
We play 56 regular season games. Yeah. I mean, it's in, and you know, even from that part that we saw, KP, that laugh and that smile, yes. that's, to me, the thing I always remember about Mike Martin is just he coaches with so much joy.
The other thing is, you know how there's people that when you talk to them, they feel like every time you talk to them, they're actually genuinely interested in what you have to say.
Yes.
And he is. Like, he's always asking questions. He wants to know what your family's like. He's just a genuine human, man. He is such a joy to be around.
And ball four, leadoff walk issued by Higginbotham. Check this stat. This is one of our favorites, right? Consecutive winning seasons.
Wow.
These two programs have two of the three longest current streaks when it comes to consecutive winning seasons. Mike Martin, what he's done at Florida State. Clemson. Monty Lee now, of course, Jack Leggett years before that. And Miami might soon disappear from this list. We could have the top two in the country.
For Florida State, they made the postseason every year that Mike Martin has been there. Every single year. The first year he was there, they went to the College World Series.
Bornegal lays down the bunt. They'll try to get the out at second. They can't. Wilkie throws it away. And with that, Salvatore goes to third, and Florida State's in big-time business.
Okay, now they don't do this a lot. Florida State's not a team that sack bunts a lot. They'll get you so many times because they're so patient at the plate. They're always top five in the country in walks. But the one thing, and I didn't mind the decision right away by Wilkie, but then he just kind of stood up. Instead of staying low through this throw, when he stands up, the ball sails on him, and as it sails, now they've got a chance. If the throw's online, the out's there at second base. It's got to be a good throw. But if the throw's online, they get the lead out. I think the one thing that gets lost in the bunt at the college game is that it forces the defense to defend.
Yes.
So we talk about it at the major league level, and it gets, you know, obviously gets destroyed at that level. Well, the reality is the defense is significantly better at the major league level. There's nothing wrong with sometimes forcing a college defense to defend.
Stephen Wells belts one into the gap in right center field. That is down. Florida State at least going to tie the game. Salvatore scores. Bornegal will stay at third, and that is an RBI double for Wells, who beat Clemson two nights ago with a 13th inning homer, and he's just tied this game with nobody out.
And, guys, the offensive approach that Mike Martin Jr. instills in this club, you get the leadoff walk, you get the sack bunt, and he's firing Wells' first pitch. That is so on point for an RBI situation. Don't wait around. Doesn't have to be a perfect pitch. Get something you can put in the outfield. That is beautiful. Their team offense is as good as anybody's nationally.
Yep. They really know who they are.
Yes, well said.
It's top to bottom. Tonight they're going to hunt fastballs. They've now got a few. Florida State, though, two hits in the last inning. Now that double right there ties the ballgame.
So here's Jackson Luke now with a chance to punch in a couple more if he can deliver a base hit here with nobody out in the fifth.
you can ignore the 241 on this kid. This kid is an immense talent.
2 for 10 at the moment in this series here at Clemson. First pitch inside, strike. At least called that way.
If he's getting that pitch, KP, that's a long night for right-handed hitters now.
Yeah.
You got to stand in the on-deck circle. Then you go away, and it's Luke sitting there thinking, this is just unfair. Like, I got to cover about 10 feet of plate right now.
Two on, nobody out. The 0-2 to Jackson Luke, the junior. Check swing. Did he get a piece of that?
Yeah, I think it might have been
a foul ball.
For me, KP, if you're Higginbotham, you got to just jam that fastball in there. That's the pitch you can trust. And if Luke gets to it, tip your hat.
Luke, little slow roller. It's going to stay fair. The throw goes into the outfield. That's a second error from Wilkie in the inning. One run scores. Luke ends up at second. Wells is on third. And Clemson is shooting itself in the foot right now. 3-2 Florida State.
I didn't think there's any way this ball would stay fair. And I'm not sure if Kyle Wilkie, the catcher, thought it was going to stay fair either. And he's the only one that can make this play based on where it is. But when you see a swing like this and the ball spin, generally that ball's going to either catch the cut and go into foul territory or just end up there on its own. But that first spin, it looked like the ball was definitely going foul. Then Wilkie clears himself from the runner but just kind of tugs it. Throws it right in the dirt. Another run scores. So two errors on the catcher in this inning alone. Both of them throwing errors.
I tell you guys, there's something to be said for two-strike approach and just make contact with the baseball. Force the defense to make plays.
So now it's Applin, still two in scoring position in a 3-2 Florida State game.
I tell you guys, I'd like to see a visit right now. Because if you're Higginbotham, this is, even for the Clemson defense, this is spinning pretty fast right now. And Applin might be the best pure hitter Florida State has.
So 1-0 now to Applin. That ball hit off the inside part of the bat. Oh, what a play out and left by Jolly. I didn't think he had a chance to get to that. One away. That looked like it was going to drop to me. But instead, it's one out now. And the dangerous Raleigh steps in. Watch Jolly make the play.
Well, remember, Applin had already doubled down at left field line earlier in the game. Shot it down the left field line back in the fourth inning. But that one on a full swing. Pretty good read by Jolly. He comes all the way in full speed. There's no way the base runner Wells can take a chance right there. That plays right in front of him. And would have been an easy double play. That's a big out because you get one of the hottest hitters in this lineup.
Boy, they needed that out. There you go.
Now they're going to put Raleigh on. Remember, you don't have to throw the pitches anymore. Say, we want to put him on. You put him on. So now they are loaded for Mendoza.
That rule is especially important when you got a left-hander on the mound who can't throw anything straight. No offense to left-handers, KP, but left-hander doing pitch outs and intentional walks.
I don't mind you offending left-handers. That's all right.
Now we've got another meeting. You know, sometimes there are companies who have meetings for the sake of having meetings. I feel that might be the case with this crew. I have seen that, what, they've come together 3-4 times at least at this point.
Mike Martin asked something. And I don't know what it was when he walked out there, but I think that ended up forcing this meeting.
And now you see home plate ump heading back underneath, it looks like, into the dugout to check. Nope, it's a conversation now with Monty Lee for Morris Hodges.
And Cal Raleigh has got a bat in his hands.
That's right. Now, they just issued the pass to Raleigh, but you're right. Raleigh has gone back to the plate and is holding a bat. So back comes Morris Hodges towards the plate. And are they going to make him throw the ball? It looks like they may make him.
Yeah, so that's a major league rule, not a college rule.
I was thinking the same thing.
Well, let's see, though. We're not seeing Wilkie stand up and hold his right hand out either right
now. Maybe they changed their minds. Yeah, Kyle Rowley's looking at Wilkie like, hey, are we walking me or are we not walking me?
Wait.
If we're not, I got to put my gear back on.
Swing?
If not.
Do I even have the right bat?
This is unbelievably strange. Now Mike Martin Jr. over at third base wants to talk to Raleigh. Raleigh didn't have his gloves on.
Exactly,
he thinks he's walking.
He doesn't have that on. He doesn't have shin guards on. He doesn't have anything on. He's got to go gear back up.
That's awesome.
I've never seen this.
He thinks he's being punked. Now, what if they intentionally walk him now?
Oh, come on now.
Gear him up
come
and then intentionally now. Walk him. It's a mind game.
This is so strange.
Excellent music choice right here, the organ. Perfect.
Baseball and hockey. It should only be organ music.
Yes.
So now fans are frustrated with Raleigh because he's got to put his gear back on.
If they intentionally walk him now, the stadium explodes.
Oh, come on.
This is great.
He walks towards the plate.
It's usually not this hard.
Other leg.
It's usually not this hard to have a hitter actually having a bat.
I love it.
Usually it goes smoother than this.
I absolutely love it. All right. Let's throw some pitches here.
By the way, I'm totally against this. Don't you have to walk him? He's the hottest man in the stadium.
1-for-2 tonight. 6-for-11. 2 home runs in the series.
So, I like pitching to him this time and again. If you got a lead in the eighth,
that's fair.
Steven Wells on third, Jackson Luke on second. Knowles with 2 here in the fifth to take the lead. 2-1 now to Raleigh.
Now, if the score is the same in the, if you have the lead, I would never intentionally walk him. But if you're down 3-2 and you really need the double play late, then I think I'd be more for it.
Two and two. I've never seen that. If you motion that you're going to walk the guy, isn't that as good as throwing 4 pitches?
It's like,
now I'm just wondering if the motion was never actually made.
Yeah.
Did they discuss it? Raleigh thought he heard walk and went to first on his own, perhaps? 3-2 now.
I don't think that was it because it was Mike Martin that ended up walking out and causing the discussion.
Either way, it's like ice in the kicker. Raleigh does not look settled in, although this is a dangerous pitch to Cal Raleigh right here.
Raleigh to right. That'll go foul.
I don't know, guys. For me, I want Mendoza, who's a double play waiting for a place to happen. Cal Raleigh can wreck this game for you if you're Clemson.
...172nd consecutive start for Raleigh. Walked anyway, but that ball gets by Wilkie and a run scores. Higginbotham and Wilkie have had trouble playing catch all night. And now it's 4-2. Well, the first walk was less damaging.
Yes, it was.
That is pass ball officially. So that's on Wilkie, who's had a nightmarish inning right now behind the plate.
You see, Higginbotham really doesn't get off the mound there, KP, and I think he was very surprised that Wilkie didn't handle that pitch.
I don't blame him. I mean, it was a miss. Wilkie's had a rough night back there.
Hey, catching a hard throwing lefty.
It's not easy.
Yeah,
right?
I mean,
don't get me wrong.
Yep.
It's not easy. And if he misses on that side, it's probably going to cut a little bit too. So it's going to go further away from his glove side.
So one out, runners on the corners now for Mendoza. So for Kyle Wilkie, the sophomore, two throwing errors that have been incredibly costly, and now the pass ball that allowed another run in. Three in the inning for Florida State as they have a 4-2 lead.
But it starts with a leadoff walk. I'm telling you guys, if I give you $1 million and a leadoff walk, you still got a problem. I mean, it is bad news. Nothing good ever happens. I'm telling you.
I'll take my chances.
Yeah,
I will, too.
That's a good point.
I give up a run for $1 million. That's good with that.
Fair. I might have to lower the wattage on that.
Keep in mind, too, I mean, we're going to look back and say Wilkie with a nightmare inning. You know, Florida State's taken advantage. They've made Clemson pay for mistakes in a game that, as you said at the beginning, when it comes to the NCAA tournament, this is
huge,
an important ball game. 2-2 now for Mendoza.
The winner of this series, KP, this is a big part of their resume for a top eight national seed.
Absolutely.
They did X, Y, Z and won this series.
Especially if you're Florida State.
On the road.
I mean, you win it on the road, it looks even better. Florida State still has NC State coming to town. Clemson finishes at Pittsburgh. Both play out of league three-game series next weekend.
Yeah, Florida State's got phenomenal resume-building opportunities with this game. If they could get 2 out of 3 here against a top-10 Clemson team, currently sitting at 6. And then NC State, who's sitting in the top 5 right now, that's who they host 2 weeks from now. Great opportunity for them.
No question.
Punch their ticket to staying in tally. Again, RPI is 8 right now for Florida State. It's 10 for Clemson.
If Florida State can win this series, you've got a road series win at North Carolina. You've got a road series win at Clemson. That looks pretty good when it comes to Selection Monday time.
2 midweek wins against UCF.
Yep.
Who's come on lately?
So runners on the corners for Florida State. Just one away. 3 in the inning. It's a 4-2 lead. The 2-2 to Mendoza. Got him on one in the dirt. He can't go anywhere. That's 2 down. Second time tonight, Mendoza's gone down swinging.
This time it was a breaking ball. And that one has signs of life. I mean, when it's right, that one, you could see the reaction of Mendoza. It starts in the zone, ends up nowhere close to the zone. Monty Lee's going to make the slow walk out.
And he's going to the bullpen. Right arm extended. And Clemson will relieve Jake Higginbotham. We'll introduce you to the new Tiger pitcher who comes in inheriting 2 runners and has 2 outs here in the 5th. Jake Higginbotham's night comes to a close. 4 2/3, 4 runs, but 3 Clemson errors have created none of those runs being credited as earned runs to him. He's out. There are still 2 runners on base for Ryan Miller, who on Saturday did throw 3 1/3 innings, gave up 1 run on 5 hits. And early in the day, Monty Lee said he's going to come to the park and he's going to throw a little bit. If he says he feels okay after the 3 1/3 2 days ago, I'll consider him available. We didn't think we'd see him this early, though, KP.
No, we didn't, but it may be the most high-leverage situation of the ballgame. And so I love the move right here, because if you're still down 4-2 in the 8th inning, 6-2 in the 8th inning, and Florida State comes and scores a few right here, Miller may never be in the ballgame.
Yes.
So in this point, you need these outs to keep it a 2-run game. He's their best bullpen option today. We've seen this move happen a lot more at the major league level, particularly in the postseason the last few years, to where your closer spot may not be the 9th. I mean, your most important part of the ball game may be right now, to where you've got to keep Florida State off the board, get your team in the dugout.
So here's Frey, who has walked and struck out. Ground ball short.
And the inning is mercifully over for Clemson as Davidson makes the play. But Florida State gets three in the inning thanks to some defensive breakdowns from the Tigers. We'll talk to Mike Martin, NCAA record holder, when we get back. Welcome back to Clemson. Here's how the first game of the series went on Saturday night. 13th inning. Stephen Wells for the Noles puts Florida State ahead. They hang on, and with that, Mike Martin, the legendary Seminole head coach, in his 39th season became NCAA baseball's all-time winningest head coach. His team leads 4-2 here in the third game of the series, and the coach joins us right now. What was the biggest emotion you felt, Mike, when that record officially became yours?
I guess I was happy that it was over. Well, I'm just obviously an eat-up Seminole. I love Florida State University. They gave me an opportunity a long time ago, and I think the biggest satisfaction is that the record will read Florida State first, and that's what I believe.
So, Coach, your son, I think you know him, runs a really good offense. And that last inning was a good example, that good old-fashioned FSU offense. Could you speak to what it's like to have Mike Jr. with you for so long running that offense?
Well, Michael works very hard. He's constantly on the road looking for players. He works very hard with the hitters and the catchers and just does an outstanding job of coaching third and running the offense. And it's something that he is – an outstanding coach, and I don't care what his last name is, he does his job.
11, what's kept you going? I mean, when you come to the ballpark now, what gets you excited now, 39 years into this?
Seeing guys get better, seeing the guys learn the game, and so still things upset me because I don't understand some of the things that go on, but normally it's from a freshman or a first-year player, but these young men are getting better. We're playing hard. We know how difficult it is to be successful up here. We also know that two runs is not enough.
Mike, before we let you go, obviously an incredible man had the record and an incredible man has it now. But what was your relationship like with Augie Garrido?
Augie Garrido is one of the finest people you'd ever want to meet. We used to talk all the time about one thing or another. He always had praise. He always had uplifting words. He was just a guy that loved to be around young men. He influenced so many kids in his career, and he's a guy that all the players liked him. He's a guy that will always be remembered, and there's a long story that I've told before about how I met Augie, and he never blamed a player. He blamed everything on himself.
Wow. Mike, it was great to talk with you. We appreciate you spending some time with us. And on behalf of all of us at ESPN, congratulations.
Absolutely.
And we're thrilled for you.
Thank you, Dari, KP, and thanks for the great job that you all do in promoting this great game of college baseball.
You got it. Happy to do it. Good luck the rest of the ballgame.
Thank you, sir.
All right, 4-2, Florida State. One away here as Robert Jolly in that nine hole became the first out of the inning. New pitcher Clayton Kwiatkowski in. Now for Florida State as Cole Sands' night comes to an end after four innings of work.
So earlier this season, Dave Neal and I had Florida State in Jacksonville. It was the first time I'd had Florida State this year. We're standing on the field talking to 11 before the ballgame. And I looked at him, and, you know, he's always like that. He's affable. And I said, do you think this is a club that you think can get to Omaha? And his face totally changed. And he looked at me out of nowhere. He said, the day that I don't think we have a chance to get to Omaha is the day that I stop doing this.
Oh, wow.
And the fire, and it may not seem that way all the time just because of the way that he communicates. I mean, it's as comfortable a communication as you can possibly have. But don't mistake that for not having fire, because there's plenty there.
Well, he told us the story, as you see, the all-time winningest coach in the history of NCAA baseball, about a walk to the mound earlier in the series with a young pitcher who didn't seem to be comfortable throwing inside. And we could just see in the retelling of that story the passion and intensity that that man still has for this game that he coaches. And now coaches to more wins than anybody else. The winningest coaches in NCAA history
You see Jim Morris at Miami. This is his last season there. You're a former coach at
Remember
Stanford,
that guy?
Of course. Yeah.
Right. And Mark Marquis, over 1,600 wins. Gene Stevenson, who held the all-time wins record for a while. Augie Garrido, who we lost earlier this year, who was one of the greatest that this game has ever seen. And Mike Martin, who had to put into words about as well as you can.
Yep.
Who Augie was and what he's meant to this game.
Here's Kyle Wilkie, the catcher, into right field. That ball is down. Wilkie does not take much of a turn at first, and wisely so. It'll be a single for Wilkie, and with that, that's a 14-game hitting streak.
They know that arm. Stephen Wells had two outfield assists last night, and it doesn't take too many times to see that right field arm work, that you're not going to test it much longer.
I don't know if there's much prettier in the game of baseball than an outfielder with a cannon for an arm. That is fun.
Seth Beer, the right fielder, standing in 0-1 right now with Wilkie on first. Again, Clemson trying to bounce back from a three spot Florida State put on him in the last half inning. Kwiatkowski to Beer, chopper to first, and Applin makes the play to end the inning. So the base hit by Wilkie ends up doing no damage to Florida State. 4-2 as we head to the sixth. Introducing ESPN Plus, your home for more sports, more schools, more conferences, more ESPN. Stream ESPN Plus exclusively on the ESPN app for just $4.99 a month. Sign up now for ESPN Plus. You get MLS if you want it. Get a little NHL. Playoffs if you want it. I'm sold on the playoffs. Hockey.
Yeah, that's a good get.
It's a good watch anytime, is it not? Kyle Wilkie, by the way, rough go in that fifth inning. You see those three Florida State runs. Now, they had some help there because on the bunt, Wilkie fires one into center field. Shortly after that, Wilkie plays a swinging bunt and fires it into right field. Shortly after that for Wilkie, a passed ball that scored another run for Florida State. Just like that, it's 4-2.
You play this game long enough, guys, and you're going to have a night like this where the game just finds you and the game is not your friend. And, hey, let's not kid ourselves. Catching Higginbotham is no picnic. That's a left-hander with outstanding stuff, and that ball is jumping all over the joint.
That's not. And I mean, so often with his misses, if he's going to miss glove side with a fastball and it's going to cut even further, that makes it tough for everybody. The velocity was good for Higginbotham tonight. You can see signs from him.
Yes.
And it may end up be a guy that moves to the bullpen when it gets into professional baseball. But if he can go into the bullpen and that breaking ball gets a little bit better, he can control the fastball, the outside part of the plate to the lefty, he can get some guys out.
Best days are ahead for him, for sure.
Once they get the field dragged here at Clemson, it'll be 7-8-9 due up for Florida State in the sixth. Reese Albert, Mike Salvatore, and then Rafael Bornegal, the second baseman. Ryan Miller came in the fifth. Did what he needed to do. Disaster had already struck at that point, and he'll continue to work. Again, two nights ago, he went 3 1/3 innings. And earlier in the day, head coach Monty Lee said when Ryan gets to the park, he'll throw around a little bit. If he tells me he feels like he can go, we'll consider him available. If he's not, well, then he's not. He clearly is. And here we go. Reese Albert, 0-1.
He don't look tired, KP. That fastball's got some giddy up.
And you'll see that from him, too. He's not afraid to run that fastball up in the zone. Miller's not a giant strikeout guy. 38 strikeouts, 47 2/3 innings, but he didn't walk too many. Just 11 in those 47 2/3. So he's really controlled the pace when he's come out of the bullpen.
That fastball's hot. I'm in. And, you know, Miller's not their main guy. It's Riley Gilliam who's not available because he threw six and change in game one in the extra innings.
Throws a lot of ground balls. does have four saves on the year. First thought would have been, as he retires Albert, second time tonight, Albert has gone down swinging. Thought would have been, with Gilliam, their regular closer, out, perhaps Miller would be the closer in such a situation. Now, he won't be either, but that's a problem they'd love to be faced with.
Yeah, won't be at the back end, but he got him out of a jam last inning. I like the use of the fastball in this at bat, too. He elevated it, then went two-seamer down and away, then elevated again late for the strikeout.
Now the eight-hole hitter, Mike Salvatore, walked and scored back in the fifth.
And most importantly, Miller put this game back under control because it was a hot mess last inning.
Certainly not all Higginbotham's doing.
No. Tell you, though, you're a Florida State hitter. You haven't seen many straight-moving fastballs tonight. A lot of life.
Florida State trying to take two out of three from Clemson for the second consecutive season. They did it in Tallahassee last year. Coming off of taking two out of three at home against Miami last week. That might drop. Oh, it doesn't. What a play. Chris Williams, can you make it look any easier than that? Wow.
Chris Williams doesn't move great, but he's made himself into a very good defensive first baseman because his footwork around the base is outstanding, and this isn't easy. I don't care how long you've played the position. When you can't turn around and look at this ball, you got to time it up right and have some trust because you got to turn your back to the infield. And if you don't turn your back to the infield, you got no chance to make this play. Never a doubt runs.
No doubt.
Get Dabo on the phone. Possession tight end, maybe.
That's right. Third and two, I know where we're going.
Got to get a big first down, Dari?
I don't know. The Clemson needs a lot of help, guys.
That's right. They're not auditioning.
Dabo's doing all right.
That is awesome. To your point, KP, not his primary position.
No.
Kid's a catcher.
Yep. Exactly.
Well,
exactly.
He just caught it. Ground ball. Sliding right is Hall, but Davidson cuts it off, throws to first, and it gets by Williams. Easy come, easy go, right?
Right when we said it.
Oh, boy.
Because that was a heck of a play by Davidson. He's the only one that can make that play. The freshman Hall is going to the shortstop side. That ball's too deep for him to set that foot and make the throw. The only chance that they have is Davidson to make the throw across, and the throw was definitely good enough to be handled. So we start pushed up a little bit. Watch how far on the second base side he goes to make this play. Now, it's not hit hard, but that's also a throw as a shortstop you never have to make. If you're making a throw on a run, you're usually coming in towards home plate. It's not very often that you're six, seven, eight steps on the other side of second base after turning your whole body. It wasn't a perfect throw, but it was plenty good to get the out.
Well, the error does go to Williams over at first, and that's the fourth error of the game for Clemson. Their season high is five. It came back in March against NC State, so they're one away from that as we sit here in the top of the sixth. You know, the story with Florida State defensively is when it rains, it pours when it comes to defensive miscues. But it's been the problem tonight for Clemson. And Stephen Wells is looking at a 1-0 count, his fourth time up.
I guarantee you guys that Chris Williams grabs Davidson in the dugout when they go in to hit and says, hey, that's my bad. I'm catching that 100 out of 100 times.
Starting now.
That's right. Can I get a do-over? Are there mulligans left on the card? Because that's a great play by Davidson.
Yeah, awesome.
Really good play.
He's going to be special.
Yes.
This Clemson shortstop is going to be a special player.
Well, they know they got him at least one more. 1-2 now to Wells as Miller trying to get out of this sixth. Check over at first on Bornegal, and he gets back. Again, top eight national seed could help be determined potentially by what happens over these next few innings in this rubber game between Clemson and Florida State.
You know, guys, that's a big deal, but here's the other thing. This is a big series win for your kids. You know, your team, you're trying to build momentum and confidence ahead of the postseason. This is something to get your team's attention. You know, if you're Florida State, we went into Clemson and won this. If you're Clemson, we come back and win this series.
Runner goes. Ball hit into right. Beer
has it. But nobody in the stadium breathing easy on a defensive play. Not right now. Go to the bottom of the 6-4-2. That's the destination everybody wants. TD Ameritrade Park, downtown Omaha, Nebraska. Take a look at your current coaches' poll. Top 25, Florida leading the way. KP's alma mater just behind them at number two, Stanford. You look at the ACC, you've got spots there, 4, 5, and 6. UNC, NC State, and Clemson. So a strong showing by this league. The ACC, the SEC as well, having a very strong showing represented in the top 25.
Big one this weekend now in Corvallis.
Yes.
Stanford, Oregon State. Both those teams in a great spot for national seed position right now, as is North Carolina. North Carolina has, just over the course of the season, consistently got better.
Yep. No question. That said, KP, that first three, regardless of what happens at Corvallis, like for me, that's the first tier.
I agree.
Stanford, Oregon State, Florida, that those are elite teams.
Chris Williams, slow roll at a third. It does get foul. 4, 5, and 6. Williams, Bird, Cromwell coming up here in the bottom of the sixth.
Duke, a team who's been a great, I don't know if you'd call it, I mean, maybe surprised to be as high as 11th, but I think we all thought that there'd be a jump forward this year for Duke. East Carolina was in that top eight national seed discussion before Houston swept them. Florida State can get right back in the middle of it. How about the go-go Gophers now?
They're hosting right now.
Absolutely.
I'm telling you, that's a host. How about Georgia? How good's that? I mean, this is where the rankings trick you. Georgia, for me, is a top eight national seed right now.
They RPI would say RPI that. Did you guys see what Auburn did to Vandy this weekend?
Yeah. Yep.
29-6 over three games.
How about Auburn facing them in a super regional? Good luck with that. That first guy out's going to be a handful.
Here comes the 1-2 to Williams. Clemson down two. Williams leads off the sixth with a hard struck single to the left. All right, take a look at the spots number 21 through 25. How about UConn sitting there at 21?
They're hosting two, by the way, right now because their RPI is outstanding. Top 15 RPI. I mean, can you imagine we have host sites at Connecticut and Minnesota? How good would that be for the game?
Tennessee Tech won 28 in a row earlier this year, and Connecticut may have been the last team out last year.
Yes.
They were right on the edge as to getting in and out of the NCAA tournament. They are comfortably in right now.
Josh Holliday's Cowboys of Oklahoma State sitting there at 22.
Not the first rodeo at UConn. I mean, think about the big leaguers they've produced.
Yes.
George Springer, Matt Barnes, Nick Ahmed. They've put out some real players.
Jimmy Penders has a great program at UConn.
Yes.
So Williams at first, guys, for Grayson Bird. Here in the bottom of the sixth, Clemson down 4-2. Again, Florida State doing its heaviest damage in the fifth with three unearned runs, assisted by two Kyle Wilkie errors at catcher and a pass ball.
So you start, LaRoons was talking about how you don't want to face Auburn when you get into the postseason. Obviously, you got to face Casey Mize. You don't really want to face Stetson either.
Yes.
You got Logan Gilbert, who is probably going to be a top 10 overall pick.
Yes.
That would throw game one for Stetson in their regional game. There are some big-time power arms this year in college baseball. Keith Law's mock draft came out the other day, and the first six picks in that mock draft were all college players.
Awesome.
Casey Mize 1, Brady Singer 2.
See, those two go head-to-head a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah. Whew. Singer got him.
How about Singer's attitude on the mound that night? It was not lost on Brady Singer who he was pitching against.
No, you know, it's interesting. I think there's times when you go in and you face a really good offense that you're facing the club. There's other times where you go in and face a really good arm and you're facing the arm.
Who's that guy for you? Do you have one of those?
Randy Flores.
Oh, I love it.
Randy Flores was absolutely that guy when he was at SC. And I think we may have gone head-to-head four different times in 2 years, but you knew.
And does that mean you root against the Cardinals now, too?
No, I would never
kidding,
do that.
Just kidding.
You know, Flo's become a buddy, but
he's
I didn't like
best.
It for 2 years.
So one on, one out for Patrick Cromwell. You guys are talking about Brady Singer, his manager, Kevin O'Sullivan, Florida, of course, national champions a year ago. I was talking to him last night on our show and asked him about Mike Martin, who he's gotten to know so well because they play so often in the Florida State. And he said after that game, he was up.
And he sent Mike and Mike Jr. a text congratulating him. The two do have a very good, strong, healthy relationship for those rivals that play so often. Florida got the better of Florida State all three times they played him this year.
I thought it was interesting talking to Monty Lee about that before the game. I mean, just they got beat, which obviously you don't want to get beat. It's game one of a series. But just this immense amount of respect that you have for the guy on the other side of it. Doesn't take much of the sting of the loss out, but the respect is still massive.
Well, that looked a little tight there on Cromwell, but it's called a strike, 2-1.
Such a great message for coaches. I mean, you can be great and not be a jerk. You know, Mike Martin is as good as it comes as a person, doing it the right way, and look at the results. Yes.
It doesn't take a competitive component away.
So 2-1 coming to Cromwell. Williams over at first. High fly ball left field. Luke camps under it. Two down. You guys were talking about Casey Mize. That's who ESPN's Keith Law has going number one. Dominant. How about his start on Friday against Vanderbilt? 15 strikeouts, not a single walk.
Those runes, those last two numbers are absolutely insane.
Comical.
Insane. I mean, this is a mid-90s guy with four pitches and a wipeout split finger, and he's walked seven dudes the whole year.
It's like Thomas Eshelman meets Steven Strasburg meets Mark Pryor. I mean, it's like the Frankenstein of college baseball pitchers.
And I think that's why. There's many years that we get to this time, and from a draft standpoint, there's a lot of discussion about the best option. It doesn't necessarily mean they're going to go first. There isn't anybody arguing against Casey Mize. I mean, it is as across the board. I was talking to a scouting director earlier this year who doesn't pick first, picks a little bit further down the draft, and he looked at me and said, you know what? I wasted a trip earlier this year because I went to
see
Mize.
He won't be around.
Yes, and he's like, he's not going to be there when we're picking.
Already looking at real estate in Detroit, who has the first pick.
Uh-huh. And he's a guy, too, you can move as fast as you want to move through a system. He throws four pitches for a strike. He throws mid-90s and has zero control issues.
Sam Hall, two on, two out, 1-0 now. Now, Casey can ask his conference mate, Alex Fiedo, about real estate in Detroit, I suppose. They took him last year.
He was a steal at 18 in the first round last year. That was...
You know what was great about that? Was I was calling that Super Regional game through. I was calling it Florida-Wake Forest.
Yeah.
He gets drafted. An hour later, he slams the door shut on a 2-0 win coming out of the bullpen.
Out of the pen, yeah.
To go to Omaha.
That's the one thing, and I don't want to go down this rabbit hole far, but We got to figure out a way to get the draft off of a game where guys are actively playing.
Yes.
When it's the most important game that they're playing the entire season. I think we can figure it out. Major League Baseball and the college game, that relationship is considerably better than it was in the past, and there's more discussions about doing more things together.
Well, in fairness, in that situation, I don't know if you remember that, Super. I'm telling you, it was Noah's Ark in game
two. Oh, yeah.
And so everything got pushed back.
But it wasn't too long ago. I mean, Dansby Swanson got drafted, what was it, 10 minutes after?
Yeah, Super
after
Illinois.
Game. Absolutely.
Yeah, Super Regional,
to
your
happen.
Point.
No question, it happens. Absolutely. Sam Hall with an opportunity here. He singled and struck out. And then he sends this one skyward into shallow left field. The shortstop, Salvatore, comes over and can't make the play. It is a foul ball. Everybody will head back.
That ball stayed in the air for a long time for Luke not to be closer to it.
Yeah.
Didn't it?
I mean, as athletic as he is, I wonder if he did not see this very well off the bat.
Let's see where he started. Look how far, though, into that left center field gap he is starting. He got it as good a jump as he would have gotten on that.
Yep. Yeah, and he was running the whole way. Yeah. He was just pushed too far to the center field side.
Yeah, that's a positioning challenge right there. There's a lot of real estate to cover.
And that's one of those, too. When you're on the mound and that ball goes up, your first thought is the inning's over.
Yep.
And now you got to reset quick because the inning's not over. Now you got to go back to work.
So the tying run standing on first for the Tigers. It is Drew Wharton. Chris Williams on second after he led the inning off with a single. The 1-2 to Hall. We'll do it again. about the pop that Clemson's got, guys? Sitting third in the country in home runs behind Tennessee Tech, who leads in about every offensive category. And then Arkansas sitting there two bombs ahead.
Second place is the real first place there, because Tennessee Tech, yes, that doesn't even count anymore. It's like that race is over.
Yeah. Hall right back at Kwiatkowski. Inning over. Threat over. Lead remains for Florida State. We go to the seventh. Knowles trying to pick up another big-time road win. Get up tomorrow, 7 a.m. Eastern on ESPN. Greeny, Beetle, Jalen, who takes you on the court to show you how the Cavs and Celtics on the verge of sweeps. However, Boston will not get one because Philadelphia did get the better of the Celtics 103-92 in Game 4. Trailblazers star C.J. McCollum, Hornets Dwight Howard with their take on the NBA playoffs. Joe Namath jumps in as well. That's Get Up, 7 Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app. Runes, your Sixers hung on for one more fight.
All right, I didn't love the way you said that. Like, of course they did. This is the city of toughness and charisma. Celtics have stolen three games.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Runes, what was Super Bowl night like for you?
That's what we needed a Snoop.
You need to ask my wife, Jenny, about that. It was. I didn't act like a great adult that night. I wasn't. Maturity was not
at least
an 80.
At least you weren't climbing light poles.
Yeah, I didn't climb. There was no need for Crisco on light poles, but...
Jackson Luke here leading off for Florida State. The seventh, Knowles, 9 outs away from a big, big road series victory. Oh, ouch. Goodness. Eek. Heel, foot, ankle. We'll find out soon enough exactly where it hit Jackson Luke.
So you wear the shin guard, you're thinking you're pretty safe on that front foot until this happens.
It missed it. It might have got the strap at best. Yeah. If you ever wonder why Cal Raleigh had to put two shin guards back on earlier when the intentional walk disappeared.
Like a rain delay for Cal Raleigh to get uniformed up.
Opportunity for insurance here against Ryan Miller as that ball is struck into center by Rhett Applin on the first pitch. Wharton makes the play.
I'll tell you guys, you talk about team offense. You give Florida State a leadoff base runner, and they always score. So if you get a zero here and you're Ryan Miller, that is a huge momentum changer.
Now here's the aforementioned Raleigh. Singled in the second, struck out looking in the fourth. Intentionally walked in the fifth, but then they changed their mind. Came back. Then he walked for real, and now he delivers his second hit of the night. You talk about first pitch swinging. What are we seeing in the approach this inning from Florida State?
Well, jumping on fastballs, I mean, I think the one thing you know when Miller's in there, he's going to throw you a ton of strikes. And right here, Cal Raleigh, who just seems like he's squaring everything up. And it doesn't matter what side of the plate it is, where they're throwing him. That one, he stays on, shoots it to left field. Switch hitting catcher who can catch and throw, hits from both sides of the plate with legit power. There's teams that have liked that for years, and I think they still do, Runes.
Yeah, high baseball IQ, son of a baseball man, Todd. I mean, when you see a hitter take fastball away and scorch it the other way, you know that hitter's on it.
So Drew Mendoza now with two on and one out. As for Raleigh, guys, how about having a series? He is 7-for-12. In this three-game set at Clemson.
With two bombs.
How about this? He originally committed to Clemson.
Absolutely.
That hurts a little bit.
So did Jackson Kowar. So when Jack Leggett left, they had those two guys coming in. Switch hitting catcher Cal Raleigh, who's going to be a high draft pick. Jackson Kowar is going to be a first-round draft pick this year, the right-hander from Florida.
That was a fairly good recruiting class.
I think this club would look a little bit different. They're pretty good now.
But then the coaching change happened, and so their decisions changed. And in the case of Raleigh, to Florida State's benefit, without a doubt.
This is the guy they got to get going. Sorry, they got to get Mendoza going. This kid's a super talent.
1-for-3 tonight. Now he's looking at a 3-1 pitch coming his way from Ryan Miller.
Green light, be careful here.
Yes.
Miller threw 3 1/3 innings 2 nights ago. He's at 1 2/3 right now, if my math is right. Now, I didn't go to Stanford, KP. I've got 5 innings of work in the series for Ryan Miller.
Took me 8 years to get out of there, Dari. I'm not sure if I'm the guy to ask.
This is so scary, KP, because you're Mendoza. You can cheat for fastball. And if he's on time, he gets one middle in, that's not staying with us.
And it's 3-2.
If you ever thought you might want to call pitches in a baseball game, think about calling this one right here.
Not what do you fun. Got? What do you got?
I would try and do that fastball kind of up and away again. Just something he can't pull. Down and in is the danger zone right here. Down and in changes the scoreboard.
Jackson Luke's got him occupied over there at second. What do you got now?
That's trying to go in.
Was he really?
They were trying to go in. They moved all the way in. Yeah. If I'm missing here, I'm not missing on the inner third of the play.
No. And that's where. Oh, goodness. Oh, good. See, now you're calling pitches and we're missing spots like that. That's where slider scares you, KP. Slider runs into the barrel if you don't bury it.
Good take.
Yep. And they are loaded for Skyler Frey. Let's look at it one more time, make sure he didn't go around, and he didn't.
That's a real good at-bat for Mendoza. That you, if you're Mike Martin, you want to see a whole bunch of at-bats like that.
Yep. Boys, if you haven't noticed the... Well, I'll explain that in a moment. We've got a pinch hitter into the game for Florida State. Nick Durr right now pinch hitting for Skyler Frey. Florida State infielder takes the first pitch. It is a strike.
I think you're trying to go fastball away there, and there you ran it in.
It's happened a few times when he's tried to throw fastball to glove side. I mean, the natural movement for Miller is going to move at arm side, and it moves pretty good that way. So usually that guy, it's a lot more comfortable to throw it to the arm side and just let the ball keep going.
And 1-2 now to Durr. Durr, the 6-foot sophomore from Sarasota. Started 34 games this season. Got a little bit of a break in this one. Took over that everyday second base spot from Rafael Bornegel earlier in the season. Bornegel starting at second here. Durr pinch hitting, and now he's sitting at 2-2 with a huge bases loaded opportunity, trying to give Florida State a little insurance up 4-2 right now.
No place to put him, KP, but I honestly like slider better than fastball here. Roll him over, and he has thrown it a bunch for strikes.
Two down.
I was with you. I thought we may see a slider right here. Instead, it's the elevated fastball. And I'm not sure if he's trying to throw it this far up and out of the zone. But for Nick Durr, maybe a little bit jumpy. First at bat of the game. Hasn't been in there. You come in, you got the bases loaded. And you're facing a guy that does throw a ton of strikes. That time swung on a pitch that would have made it a 3-2 count.
Tough assignment.
Yep.
Reese Albert now up. Now, Albert has grounded into a double play and struck out twice. Can Miller get out of this mess? Again, I know you guys can probably smell it. We have had a delivery.
Oh,
from the Cajun Cafe.
Was that right?
We'll have to roll the sleeves
up. Perhaps the best part of coming to Clemson for baseball. Miller, 1-1 now.
I think we were an hour before game time. when you first asked if there was going to be a delivery from the Cajun Cafe.
Every time I've been here, they have come through. And here they are again, waiting for a commercial to serve it up, like Miller hopes he doesn't do. 2-1 now. Yeah. Strong.
Strong to quite remember. Strong.
No, I don't forget. You get food deliveries when you're calling ball games? You know what? Miami, Mark like shake, right?
Very good.
Oh, yeah.
World famous.
You've done a game Mississippi State.
2-2. I have not. I have not.
Everett drives a bus all over the place for Mississippi State Athletics. When he brings the ribs up, I take the headset off.
Make a
That's
mess,
a half-inning tap-out. I'll be back in a little bit, but I've got a little work to do.
Big moment here, guys. Ryan Miller, 2-2 to Reese Albert, who has struck out twice but can build his team's lead in the seventh. Just off the plate, and it's full.
It gets dicey now because you got runners in a dead sprint.
Start that two-seamer over the middle part of the plate. Just let it go. I don't think you'd be too too concerned about trying to dot the outside black right here. Let the movement of the pitch take over.
Got him looking. Ryan Miller, emotional as he exits the mound. Could have been so bad. Instead, it stays 4-2. We say Cajun Cafe delivers. Look at this. Fries, ribs, mac and cheese. Look at our friends here.
So good.
Yeah, Sheridan.
Yes.
Matt bringing the delivery to us. We'll try not to eat and chomp too much while we're calling baseball, but I can't promise you anything. Thank you all so much.
Yes, you guys
are
awesome.
We appreciate it. Absolutely.
That's outstanding.
You cannot come here and not hit the Cajun Cafe.
And carb-free, gentlemen, I'm told.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
right. So amazing.
Yeah. Carb-free.
How do you guys do that?
Carb-free. This is a wonderful offering.
You guys are magicians.
All right. Beautiful.
Yes.
Yeah, you and I have white shirts on. That's a big mistake.
It's the shirt.
Well, thank you all. Matt Sheridan, thank you all so much.
Yes, you guys are awesome.
I don't get nervous around you very often, Rose, but you holding that food like that made me a little bit nervous.
That was a little shaky.
You can drop a lot of things, but don't drop this.
Do not drop that, Runes, at all. All right, Kwiatkowski comes back out for his third inning of work.
We got food, Sam. We got good food tonight.
As we have sung, we have stretched, and Clemson going to try to come back here in the seventh. They're running out of outs. Jordan Green pinch hits. First pitch right back at Kwiatkowski, who makes the play. And it's quickly one out here in the bottom of the seventh. How about an ESPN Plus matinee for you Tuesday? Twins and Cardinals playing the second game of their two-game set before they both head to the West Coast. Jake Odorizzi, Carlos Martinez doing battle. 1:15 Eastern. This one also streaming live on the ESPN app. So make sure you start your free trial of ESPN Plus. It is new and improved. And you can do that right now.
Cards get a walk-off last night, sweep the Cubs.
I turned it off. Too much rain for me. I couldn't handle
it. Stop.
Top of the order. Logan Davidson.
Boy, this is a big at-bat for Clemson right here, boys. They're starting to run out of real estate.
Yeah, this may be the last time the top of the order gets up here. Maybe. Davidson, 6'3", sophomore from Charlotte. Switch hitter. Hitting from the right side here against Clayton Kwiatkowski,
who's been very good.
Yes.
And that was the one question, is how far can Sands go, and then ultimately how deep is his Florida State bullpen? It's got taxed pretty good over the course of the weekend. But Kwiatkowski's done his job, and this is the Clemson offense on this swing. It was a two-run home run by Davidson back in the third inning. It gave Clemson the lead at that point, 2-0. Florida State to go 1-4, 3-5 to take the lead back.
That ball fouled off, and it does get out of play.
Ninth home run of the season for the shortstop.
Big boy power, too. Opposite field gap. That's not for amateurs. That's legit power.
I mean, and it just backspun and carried. Yeah, you don't see that swing and that ball go out very often in the college game to where a guy stays on it and can really drive the ball out to left center field.
So few hitters trust themselves to that gap. You just get so pull-centric.
You really don't see it from a shortstop.
Here comes the 2-2 from Kwiatkowski to Davidson. And it's full. They could use a base runner. Kyle Wilkie standing on deck just hoping for an opportunity to make amends. There he is. Davidson, hard hit left, but a bullet at Luke. Two down. Nothing but a loud out.
That was leaned on.
You'll take that at bat for Clemson.
Yeah.
You need base runners, but that's maybe the best at bat they've put on Kwiatkowski in a while.
Kwiatkowski now 2 2/3 innings of relief. Has given up 3 hits, has 1 strikeout. Of course, nobody's crossed the plate. Here comes Kyle Wilkie again. 2 errors and a pass ball in a disastrous 5th inning that allowed 3 Florida State runs to score. Wilkie at the plate tonight, 1-for-2, and he's been hit by a pitch. Took one upper back in the first.
The start of a not super fun day.
How's that food doing?
Strong. It's really good.
You don't know that yet.
It's a 7-inning
but
game,
it is.
Right?
Yeah.
Carb-free offering.
Yes,
it's
right,
nice
right.
of them.
Paleo ribs. Who knew?
They're great. And 1-2 now.
We got a new program coming to Clemson next year. Well, 2020, I guess, softball program. They're going to have a brand new stadium out beyond left center field. John Rittman, the longtime head coach at Stanford, will be the head coach. And
wow.
First season to be 2020. So the sight lines from here look a little bit different here in a few years.
There's Wilkie with a base hit. And that'll again bring the tying run to the plate. So Wilkie, despite the disaster in the 5th behind the plate, does have 2 base hits for Clemson tonight.
Wilkie, a guy that wanted to make amends. And Seth Beer, another guy that hasn't had the best series.
No. And they need him.
Yes.
They need him. I know there's a lot of thump in this offense, but there's nobody that's more feared than that guy.
When he's locked in and right, it's one of the best hitters in the country, bar none. I mean, just it's a first 2 rounds hitter.
Has hit 47 home runs in his collegiate career.
Yep.
He hit one yesterday, number 13 on the season. So far tonight, he's hit into a fielder's choice and twice grounded out to Rhett Applin over at first.
And you know what, guys? That's been Seth Beer ever since freshman year. Just nothing but cross count. Breaking balls early in the count, fastballs occasionally. For me, KP, it's worn on him a little bit. He just does not get much to handle.
Yeah.
And to his credit, he's very selective. Great eye at the plate, just 27 strikeouts.
The walks to strikeouts since he's been here, and that was his freshman year all the way through, have been fantastic. I mean, if you're, which everybody is now, not if you, but from a high on-base percentage standpoint, I mean, this is your guy. His on-base percentage his freshman year was above 500.
Yep.
And it's down a little bit this year just because the average is down a little bit, but he's selective. I mean, it's a rare combination for a guy that is that selective. Strikes out some, but it's not a ton, and has the power that he has. Left-handed power still plays pretty well in the big leagues.
Monty Lee, head coach, was talking about the first half of his freshman season and how unbelievable it was, something he'd never seen before. And it, unfortunately, I think for Beer, he's constantly being put against that.
Yes.
It's tough to match. The 0-2 coming his way. That looks to be a gapper in left center. And back is the left fielder. Goodbye. You wanted thump? You got your thump. Seth Beer ties the game. Number 14.
That is awesome. That's when you know you're a little frustrated in this series, and it's a big series, and your team really needs you, and you come up large. That is massive for Seth Beer.
How about where he did it, though?
Yes.
I mean, some guys that are fighting it right there are going to try to pull absolutely everything, get everything started. Beer trusted, drives that out to left center field. Both home runs tonight for Clemson. Left-handers that have taken the ball the other way.
There are three players in the ACC with 14 home runs. Beer is one of those three. So is the man at the plate right now, Chris Williams. How about the reaction? That was just, my goodness. You talk about monkey off your back a little bit right there. How much did he need that?
And I'll tell you, boys, if that's the at-bat that gets his end of the season going,
look out.
Look out is right. Like, that's a factor.
I mean, that's left on left, driving a ball about 395 feet the other way.
Wow. The zone is wide tonight. Home plate ump Morris Hodges at times has been very generous. And Williams goes down swinging.
We got a ball game, gentlemen. Just when you thought it was safe to pitch to Seth Beer again, I beg to differ. That's fastball away, and we're going oppo juice right there. Seth Beer tying this up at four.
Welcome back to Clemson. It has gotten awfully interesting. Seth Beer with a two-run shot, bottom of the seventh off Clayton Kwiatkowski. What do you think the message is here that pitching coach Mike Bell might be discussing?
I'm going to tell you something. If a dude takes a pitch that's 4 to 6 inches off the plate and hits it in the seats, to me, I take that if I'm Mike Bell. Like, you were trying to throw the pitch there. You just got beat by an All-American. I mean, a guy that's got a chance to play this game and get paid for a long time. Sometimes that happens. Yep. Sometimes the guy on the other side is just a little bit better. Seth Beer was just a little bit better.
And I'll tell you, good on Kwiatkowski to come back and strike out Williams. That really shows you something. You have a big moment like that, and you come back and get the punch out.
Watch location. I mean, watch where they're trying to go and what happens. He didn't miss the glove. Is it a little bit elevated? Yeah, it's a little bit elevated. The guy just put a really good swing on it.
And again, KP, to your point, I mean, Seth Beer's had a special career at Clemson, and that's just another chapter in it right there.
Absolutely.
So Mike Salvatore leading off for Florida State, 8-9-1, but he's got a new pitcher to face, number 23, Carson Spires, a sophomore into the game now, relieving Ryan Miller. Also a couple of defensive changes. In the seventh, Jordan Green pinch hit. Jordan Green comes in. He is now playing second base. Sam Hall slides from second out to left field. So freshman left fielder Sam Hall, Jordan Green at second, and Carson Spires on the mound. And the first batter he faces, he gets looking.
Speed him up, slow him down. Speed him up, slow him down. And for Spires right there, fastball early, and then just the inability of Salvatore to pull the trigger on this one. Watch his slow breakable. And about right now, you know you're done.
You're a right-handed hitter facing one of those funky guys, and then they start spinning it. It's white flag time. That's no bueno.
So Bornegal steps in. Bornegal so far in the game, 0 for 3. Did score a run back in that three-run Florida State fifth. Gave him a two-run lead before Seth Beer wiped that out with a two-run shot. All right, again, Jordan Green came in to pinch hit in the last inning for Robert Jolly. Jolly's out of the game. Jordan Green over to second. Sam Hall was at second. He slides out to left field where Jolly once played. So Hall in left, Green at second. Here for Clemson in the eighth.
Good on Sam Hall to be able to do that, by the way. I mean, that's the way you get yourself some playing time in the postseason. You can play multiple positions when late game situations really matter.
You talk to Monty Lee, I mean, he'll tell you there may not be a position on the field that Sam Hall can't go play. He's a freshman they're excited about.
Big-time foot speed. He was thrown out trying to steal earlier today, but that was the first time he's been thrown out trying to steal this year. Starts the game at second, pushes to left. If you need to move him to short, he can play short. Pretty impressive for a freshman that's making just his sixth start of the year.
Yeah, you're Monty Lee. You love any options you get, right? Any head coach would love options like that from a freshman. There's... So Bornegal now gets the pass over to first. So Florida State, one out and one on to the top of the order for Stephen Wells. Wells, third. Cromwell to second for one. Green, can he turn it? Yes, what a dig at first by Williams. Remember earlier when Williams let one get by? Heck of a play there.
He can move around over there all right now. And he dropped one that he shouldn't have dropped. You know it's on his mind right here, but off the bat, it looks like it has a chance to be a double play. It's a good feed from Cromwell. Green just into the ball game. Short hops it, and Williams picks him up. To the bottom eight, we got a ball game tied at four at Clemson.
The destination, Omaha, Nebraska. Both Clemson and Florida State have been there plenty of times, though both programs still seeking national championship number one. 12 trips to Omaha for Clemson, 22 for Florida State. Take a look at their tournament resume. The first goal, top eight national seed. And this game could go a bit of a ways. Mike Rooney in determining which one might get one, unless they both do.
I'll tell you a number that sticks out, too, against the RPI top 50. Those 16 wins tied for second in the country. The only team that's better is Florida right now. So, I mean, does Florida State still have some work to do to make sure they're a top eight? Absolutely they do, but they got time. I mean, yes. You win this series, you play NC State at home. Those are two loud series wins at the end of the year.
And let's be honest, guys, whoever wins this game tonight in this week's projections, they're a top eight national seed. That's a fact.
Absolutely.
Dari Noka, Mike Rooney, Kyle Peterson with you here in Clemson, South Carolina. New pitcher on the mound, the third of the night for Florida State. He is a freshman, Connor Grady, out of Tampa. They got a lot of freshmen in that bullpen, guys, and they utilize several of them. A little up and down on the year, couple of saves. Last appearance, though, came against Miami, and he struggled. He'd like to erase that taste.
No question. These are kids with a lot of pedigree, but they're going to be in big situations from here on in.
Bird, Cromwell, and Wharton. And whoa, did that one sail from Grady.
Hit the bowl.
Hide the mascot.
That's right.
It's
the ninth arm that Florida State has used over the course of the week.
Ooh.
I mean, you travel a lot, but you don't necessarily think all of them are going to get in the ball game. And this is a wee one that got away. It's a pretty good way to come back.
Yeah, I was going to say, how about a little bounce back there to get Bird?
It's all part of the plan. Throw one in the backstop, punch him out.
Set up.
You got him on his toes. Coming up, SportsCenter tonight, 11 Eastern, following Twins and Cardinals. Reaction from LeBron and the Cavs as they try to sweep Toronto. Plus, Stephen A. Smith joins the show. Boston could not close out Philadelphia. Reaction to the Sixers staying alive there at baseball's top moments for Monday. John Anderson, Kenny Mayne coming your way. SportsCenter 11 Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app. So, nobody on, one out here for Patrick Cromwell, who's 0 for 3 with a couple of strikeouts tonight for Clemson. Bottom eight, tie game. If you've missed it, well, we're glad to have you aboard. Better late than never. Seth Beer with his 14th home run of the season tied it in the seventh. Florida State, 3 in the fifth to take a 4-2 lead, aided by two Clemson errors, both from the catcher, Kyle Wilkie, as well as a pass ball. And that's where we sit now, 4-4.
Tell you what, boys, this has a regional feel to it, this game.
Yes, it does.
I mean, you can feel it.
Ow. How about Grady coming in, the freshman, with back-to-back strikeouts?
Either a backdoor slider, that a good sinker, a changeup, he turns over right there. Let's see what the hand is when he goes over the top. Look like a changeup. Changeup that just runs all the way away. That's got good late action. So back-to-back strikeouts for the freshman since he threw one to the backstop. He knows what he's doing now.
That's right. Design pitch.
That's right.
Wharton now steps in, singled in the sixth. His last time up, he's 1 for 3.
Wow.
Nobody can touch Connor Grady except the backstop on one pitch.
The scouting report's sinker slider, but now we got a changeup in the mix. Cromwell's back in the dugout like, let me have out the scouting report because it's garbage.
Who watched this guy?
Wow.
2-3-4 due up for Florida State in the ninth. Big opportunity coming for the Noles if they can get to the ninth. Still tied. Luke Applin and then Cal Raleigh. Here comes the 0-2. 1-2.
I know pace of play is an initiative and it's important, but in a game like this, if I'm Clemson, somebody needs to step out and like pull the fire alarm because this Grady is cruising.
Yeah. Can we do anything else besides the fire alarm?
Maybe just an offensive timeout would be better.
Step, Luke. Yeah.
I got a little
reach down,
got a little ahead of myself.
If you want. There's a few other steps before we pull the alarm.
DEFCON something. Hit the button accidentally. Sorry about that.
Hashtag find another solution.
Yes.
Skied left. Luke running in. Salvatore out. Luke will make the play. So much on the line. And in comes the freshman. Three up, three down. I told you. 2-3-4 for the Noles in the ninth. We're headed there next. It is Wednesday night baseball coming your way. Red Sox, Yankees. Perhaps you've heard of the rivalry. They'll play the second game of a three-game set. David Price, Masahiro Tanaka, due to head to their respective mounds. 7 Eastern, ESPN and the ESPN app.
How about our two buddies in those dugouts now?
Yeah.
Oh, colleagues.
On.
Alex Cora, Booney, both right at the top of the AL East early.
MLB, stop stealing our guys.
No kidding, man. I like those
back
guys.
Back off.
They started chirping at each other the first time they played earlier this
That's
year, too.
Oh, yes, they did. The slide into second and the fireworks after that. 2-3-4 for the Noles. Tie game. Series finale, rubber game. 2-0 from Spires to Luke. Spires working his second inning.
How's Cora, the former Hurricane? Booney went to SC. I faced Alex Cora for the first time when I was 10 years old.
No way.
Played in a 10-year-old tournament. He was playing for a team from Caguas, Puerto Rico. We played him in the middle of Ohio when we were 10. And I'll never forget him. He was the smoothest-looking shortstop you could ever see as a 10-year-old.
At 10.
Yeah. Yeah.
Luke skied into shallow left center field. It got tricky, but Hall makes the play. Remember, that's the first play in left Hall has had tonight. He started the night at second base.
He's still smiling, though. He knew he had it the whole time. Everybody's got a different route rooms.
Yeah, that was the GPS got a little mangled up there because that was not an ideal. Try Waze next time. That was not great. Only a freshman
Where
can smile about
this?
That. That's excellent. Yeah,
that's
I don't know. Good thing for the big glove, that's for sure.
Here's Applin. Doubled in a run in the fourth. It was Florida State's first run of the night. And the 0-1 now. Spires got ahead of him. Red Applin, a first baseman now, was the everyday right fielder last season before a season-ending injury after 40 games. That struck into center field. Wharton comes up a few steps. And two down.
I'll tell you what, boys, this is the time of year where if you're a reliever in big-time college baseball, you got to want this. 2-3-4, other team, ninth inning, give your chance to go walk this thing off. Like, this is what you got to want.
Well, think about it if you're Clemson, too. We've already seen Ryan Miller, who's out of the ballgame. We're not going to see Riley Gilliam, who's been probably their best out of the bullpen the entire season. So those two have been their back-end seventh, eighth, ninth guys. This is also a confidence builder as this season goes on, too, because you get into a regional setting or as the postseason goes on, you're going to need more than four or five. You're going to need that bullpen to be three, four, five deep if you can.
Because Riley Gilliam can't pitch every game.
No.
And he's one of the best arms in this whole league.
Yes.
That ball struck into center field, and that will get down. Cal Raleigh with his third hit of the night.
Eighth of the weekend.
How
decent,
that, huh?
Yeah. Stay caliente. I mean, goodness gracious.
8 for 13 this weekend.
He could get a hit blindfolded right now. Like, that's where we're at. It's almost a joke.
Man.
Cannot make an out. It's not possible.
And it's important, obviously, to have him standing on first base, but now you get another chance for Mendoza.
Yes.
You get a guy that can make it 6-4 in a blink of the eye.
So Mendoza sends that one foul 0-1. Guys, on the mound, Carson Spires, the sophomore. Long history of baseball, of course, in that family. We all know the name Spires well. His grandfather, Bud, played from 57 to 59, was a shortstop on Clemson's first World Series team. His uncle, Bill, who also played football as a punter, played 85 to 87. His dad, Michael, 88 to 91, played in the outfield. That could be trouble, though, for Spires' team right now. That ball is caught! Somehow, that ball is caught. Sam Hall.
Told you he could run now.
Wow, Sam Hall.
Now, it's not the most comfortable route that we've seen both times, but ultimately, it's the final act that matters. The freshman just made a game changer right there, Runes.
Yeah, this has got 5-4 written all over it. You're going up that hill out there, by the way, into the fence. That is some kind of play right there.
I'm too tempted not to say it. What the Sam Hall just happened? Two plays out there and left. One he made a little more difficult than he needed to. That one was just difficult.
Monty Lee said today he's the most athletic guy that we have on the field. And it gives him the ability to put in different places. And athleticism makes up for route sometimes.
Yes.
Athleticism just made up for some route right there because he had to make an adjustment right at the last minute to make that play. Because if that lands, this ball game's 5-4.
He's making another adjustment now because he's leading off in the bottom of the ninth.
Of course he is.
How often do you see it? One
That's
out
amazing.
Of nine times.
The baby-faced freshman. In the chat from his head coach, Monty Lee. The two-run homer from Seth Beer in the seventh tied it up, and here we go to the bottom of the ninth. Rubber game of a three-game set. So much on the line. Two teams hoping to be national seeds in a couple of weeks. Two Clemson home runs have done some damage. Logan Davidson hit one in the third.
And that's the way they've scored runs all year. I mean, yes. For Clemson, it can be quick strike, and it was quick strike tonight. They're third in the country in home runs. That number continues to go up tonight. Clemson has made four errors, and they're tied
the game
on the bottom of the ninth inning.
Crazy.
Sam Hall, second inning and left tonight after moving over from second. That was the first out of the inning in the ninth, and that one was the last one.
That's not how we teach it, but no, we love it.
And Runes talked about it. Well, the thing about this field, when you look out there, you don't see a warning track. It's because it's a hill. And so you got to remember, A, it's a freshman. B, it's a freshman who hadn't been out there very much. This is start number six of the entire season. He started a ball game at second base. So it's one thing to go get it. It's another thing at the end. You're running uphill those last few steps. You know you're getting close to the fence on a play that he has not had to make too often in his life.
Look at the left upper leg area. Grass stains from what he just did out in the old slope in the outfield, similar to the old Crosley Field, rather, in Cincinnati.
These are good baseball fans, boys. You see that applause they gave?
Appreciate it.
These guys get it.
He shows bunt, does not connect. 0-1 for Hall. So 8-9-1. Hall, then Jordan Green, who pinch hit back in the seventh, and then the top of the order to Logan Davidson, who already has a home run of the game.
It's little, but it could have mattered there. You get a breaking ball right there, you got to pull it back.
Yep, bunt strikes.
Yeah, because if that's fair, it's going to deaden so fast. Raleigh's going to get it, and it's a quick out.
0-2. Rather 1-1, I should say. First one did not go for a strike. I believe it should have. Should it not have?
That miss said, did he pull it back?
I thought it was a foul ball.
He fouled it off. I stand corrected. Well, you see a breaking ball, he did pull it back.
Looking at the home plate ump to see a hand signal. Don't see one. So there's a ball. The question is it ball one or is it ball two? If we go by the scoreboard, it's ball two, 2-1. Let's watch this again. This is the first pitch at the bat here. I did two.
No, just the last minute.
Yeah, maybe he got it back. All right, 2-1 to Hall. That's fouled off of his foot.
All right, now we're level set. How about this, boys? I mean, this feels like game three of a super regional in the ninth inning. Yeah. You got two freshmen going at it. Goodness, this is how it plays out.
Grady was so good in the eighth.
Carvage.
Speaking of Carvage, have you tried your ribbon?
No, you're not.
Carnage.
He's so good.
1-2. Now they say 1-2. Whatever the case, that is nearly caught by Applin. Our scoreboard shows 1. Okay, now they both say 1-2. So now that first pitch has gone back to being a strike.
That is inches. It looked like Applin didn't. It's one of those cue shots where you just have no idea where to run. Looked like he came in first.
Swing and a miss.
Whew. Okay, so we talked about it earlier, to where if you've got one where guys are not making good swings, don't give them a chance and don't go with anything else. And I like that the freshman stayed with it right there, because there were not comfortable swings there by Hall against the slider. And if you throw him a fastball, it's coming back into the barrel, you really give him a chance. Instead, stays with the slider. That looks to be Grady's best pitch. Gets a big leadoff strikeout right there.
Here's the thing, though, KP. I need you to explain this to me. The kid threw a fastball off the mascot, and yeah, now we're painting sliders. Like, what happened there?
Different ways to set people up, Bruce. I mean, you don't have to just miss the zone.
I mean, just...
Here's Jordan Green, who pinch hit in the seventh. Green deep to left. You've got to be kidding me. Season for Jordan Green. What else can we see? We've seen it all. Walk off Clemson. They take the final two of the series. How dramatic is this?
I'll tell you, boys, that's an awesome weekend of college baseball right there. There's history made, and then a magic moment like that.
Yep. And you got a feeling that's what Monty Lee is saying to Mike Martin right now in a handshake line. Just a level of appreciation for what he saw the first game of this series, and then obviously a level of appreciation for what the balance of this series was. That was a blast. And for a kid who hit his fifth home run of the ballgame, but he didn't start. Jordan Green did not start this ballgame. He comes in a pitch hit in the seventh inning, saw one pitch, grounds back. He saw one pitch here, and it's a fastball elevated, and the ballgame's over. Think he knew he got it?
Oh, that was how good is that?
Yep. It's a lonely feeling on the mound, but it's not too lonely right there. When you start looking at the bench and you know the ball game's over, man, that is some sweet way to end a weekend.
How good is that?
I love that celebration, because that's with your teammates. That's not showing up
that's
the pitcher.
Right, no.
That's firing up your boys.
Well, and it's just pure emotion. I mean, when you get to that point, he's not showing anybody up. He's fired up, man. They just won a series, and both of these clubs fighting for national seeds. Both these teams have a chance to play for a while when we get into the postseason. I mean, you can find warts with almost anybody in the country, but there is plenty of flash in these offenses and a ton of flash in this Clemson offense.
I want to ask you a question, and I'm not trying to slight Jordan Green. Why would I after that? Connor Grady's a freshman.
Yeah.
Is there a chance he had Logan Davidson on deck in his head more than he had Green at the plate?
I'll tell you what surprises me about that is if you had watched Grady up to this point, if you're going to sit on one pitch, I'm sitting first pitch slider. Because that's what it seemed like he's getting everybody out with. And he elevated a first-pitch fastball, and Green ended it. Like, to have that reaction, and maybe he's going up there saying, if he throws me a first-pitch cookie, I'm going to end this thing. But if you're looking for one pitch based on what you had seen to that point, I got to think you're looking slider, and he hammered a fastball.
Well, that's the approach against Grady. If you got to see it up, because that slider was filthy.
How about this moment for that young man?
Awesome.
the win. Clemson gets to 36-12, drops Florida State to 32-16, and frankly, guys, they may just flip-flop RPI spots.
Yes.
Or they're... Florida State may not drop. What may happen is we may have two in the top eight, potentially. Well,
but here's what you have for both. So they both play off next weekend, non-conference, three-game series, and then both end in conference. Clemson goes to play Pittsburgh. NC State heads to Tallahassee. For both of these teams, they each control whether or not they're going to be national seeds at this point in the season. I think if you fight this far, that's all you want. Like, if they finish strong, I think both of them end up national seeds. There are a very good chance of it. North Carolina has the first pecking order right now for me in this league. But it's definitely not out of the question. This league gets three.
Yep.
And I think it's virtually a lock that they get two.
You've got five strong RPIs when you go UNC, NC State, Duke, and these two as well.
Yeah. And, guys, these two teams are chasing, like, Texas Tech, the right. kind of next group of SEC schools. Here's what I'm seeing for Clemson. You know, you're now 19-8 in the ACC.
Yeah.
You're in a great spot. But Florida State, you're 14-12 in the ACC. That's the problem. You need ACC wins.
Yeah, Jordan Green.
It's going to take at least two out of three against NC State if you're Florida State right now.
The 5'8 junior is the hero. Jordan, you come in the seventh. You ground to the pitcher. The next pitch you see, you belt into left. Take us through that at bat. Your approach.
We'll see if we get audio down there. And, Jordan, if you can hear us, just keep talking about it, because if we hear you, we'll lay out. But that first, all he was doing was setting him up, fellas. That was it. That first at-bat was a setup. Ground back to the pitcher. Now just take care of it himself right there.
Unfortunately, the mic is not working. Jordan, we wanted to talk to you.
Yeah.
But congratulations to you. What an unbelievable moment. I can't imagine how this one's going to live in your memory for the rest of your life.
Yes.
Wait, do we have you now?
Yeah. Attaboy, we're back.
All right, there we go. Okay. You know what? You walk up, you ground to the pitcher in your previous at-bat. Here you go. First pitch swinging in the ninth. What's going through your mind?
Well, yeah, like you guys said, I tried to deke him, you know, better for it.
Yes, you did.
But, yeah, Coach. Oh, God. Oh, that's shaving cream, yo.
That doesn't taste good. That's not whipped cream.
That's shaving cream.
Oh, shit. Get yourself cleaned up there. Go ahead. Get yourself cleaned up.
Fight through it.
Before something else happens, I'm going to finish it.
Yeah, go ahead.
You look good, Jordan.
All right, so
if we're being honest.
Well, yeah, Coach always says you got to want to be the man, and I just had a lot of big body language, a lot of self-confidence going up to that last at-bat, and was able to put a good swing on the ball. He grooved one in my wheelhouse, though. I don't even know what to say. Even a blind squirrel finds a nut.
Hey, well, that's not the case. That's home run number five on the year. What's this win mean for this club right now?
Oh, my God, it's huge. This has really been our toughest series of the year outside of NC State. But Florida State's a great team, absolutely great team. Their pitching staff's unbelievable. I have a lot of friends. Kyle Riley, one of my good friends growing up, did absolutely unreal job this weekend. Got like 10 hits, so. Really big win for us, and we're going to take that momentum the rest of the way.
Unbelievable. What a moment for you. You'll never forget it, Jordan, and we may never either. What a great game to be at. We're congratulations to you on a great moment, a great win.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Go Tigers.
Unbelievable. Our final score, Clemson 5, Florida State 4. Walk-off fashion for Kyle Peterson, Mike Rooney, and our entire crew. I'm Dari Noka. We now take you to E60, presented by Liberty Mutual.